Good evening, everyone. Thank you all so much for coming to tonight's public safety hearing to discuss human trafficking in the city of Columbus. I'm Zach Klein. I chair the Public Safety Committee. I'd like to welcome my colleague, Councilmember Shannon Harden. Shannon, before we start the program, would you like to offer any remarks?
Thank you, Chair Klein. Just want to say that I appreciate your leadership here on this important issue, and as a council, we'll continue to follow your lead in supporting initiatives, efforts, and the great things that are happening in the community that are protecting our folks here, especially as it pertains to human trafficking. So thank you. Thank you for everyone for being here for this important hearing.
Thank you, Councilmember Harden. I appreciate those comments. Briefly before we get into this, what I consider an all-star lineup of folks that are going to be speaking on this issue, because I tell you, this group includes internationally renowned folks that speak on the issues of human trafficking, like Judge Herbert down at our municipal court. The reason why we have this hearing, besides the obvious of just how important human trafficking issues are in the city of Columbus, is when I first joined council in 2011, we had community meetings, and the issue of graffiti was always in every part of our conversation. No matter where we were, people were talking about graffiti. And then we addressed graffiti, and we created a citywide graffiti abatement program that's been immensely successful. But now when I'm out hearings, folks are talking about human trafficking. No matter where I go, folks are talking about prostitution, they're talking about massage parlors, they're talking about addiction issues, they're talking about women who are victims, not criminals, victims that are out on the streets, they're being enslaved to perform sexual activities for money, to feed their addiction by really bad criminals. And it certainly rose to the level that I thought we needed to have a hearing on it. And there is no agenda coming out of this hearing that I have in my mind. This is a blank slate. I look at this hearing as an opportunity at a minimum to raise awareness of the issue and find out exactly what the human trafficking issues are in the city of Columbus and in Franklin County, the players that are involved tackling those issues, and then collectively, with the expertise that we have in this room and with my colleagues, figuring out where we can make a difference as a community, as a city, because it's a priority of mine to address this issue and help the victims of these crimes and treat them like victims with the dignity that they deserve. So we appreciate everyone that is in attendance. Clearly, with this wonderful turnout, it is something that's very important. We are accepting speaker slips. I will accept them through the end. So if anyone wants an opportunity to speak, they can do so at the conclusion of the remarks that we have on the agenda. There's little blue slips right over here next to the box. You just can fill out your name. And then there's additional information. You can put it into the box. You'll have 3 minutes to speak at the end, perhaps answer any questions. And we usually call those in the order that they are received. So first, I'd like to turn it over to Director George Speaks, our Public Safety Director. Director Speaks.
Thank you, Chairman Klein, Councilmember Harden. Human trafficking is a form of modern-day slavery. It's mistakenly thought to occur in far-off places of the world in the shadows of modern society. Unfortunately, especially in recent years, we have seen human trafficking becoming more prevalent here in Central Ohio and manifest itself through criminal activities such as forced labor and prostitution. After years of falling behind and failing to fully understand the breadth and scope of this problem, former Attorney General Richard Cordray established the Trafficking in Person Study Commission. This commission has continued under Attorney General Mike DeWine and has shed much needed light on human trafficking occurring throughout Ohio. In 2010, this commission released a report and found that 1,000 minors are sex trafficked in Ohio each year. An additional study released in 2012 surveyed women involved in the sex trade in Ohio and found that 25% of these women were trafficked as minors. The report also detailed some of the causes and experiences that led to many of these women into the world of human trafficking. As some of today's speakers will underscore, oftentimes a victim has a traumatic childhood experience or even suffered through a pattern of abuse or neglect at a young age. Another key component is drug addiction. Oftentimes, drug dependence serves as a gateway to human trafficking, and it can make it extremely difficult for these women to free themselves from the life of sex trafficking. Understanding these aspects of human trafficking is critical to approaching the problem in a comprehensive way that serves to help those that have been victimized and does not continue to punish them. In June of 2012, the Ohio Attorney General Assembly passed the Safe Harbor Law that increased punishment for adults who profit from human trafficking and gives young victims the opportunity to go through a diversion program for treatment and counseling in exchange for having the criminal charges expunged. Here in Columbus, our Division of Police has been working with a number of other agencies, both public and private, to develop strategies that focus on enabling the human trafficking and related illegal behavior, and it gives or provides opportunities to victims to turn their life around without fear of being continuously incarcerated. Today, you will hear from two members of our Columbus Police Vice Section, Commander Gary Cameron, to my right, and in the back, Sergeant Ryan Chrysler, and they'll talk about their work on the Central Ohio Human Trafficking Task Force and what they see as working on the front lines of this struggle. Sergeant Chrysler works undercover, so the broadcast of this hearing, the audience will not be able to see his face, as we wish him to remain anonymous. The strides we've made in Ohio via updated laws and increased strategic enforcement have been great. However, there remains an ongoing problem with many other illegal behaviors that often lead to human trafficking, or most among them, again, drug abuse. You will hear from speakers tonight who will speak about these factors that lead to being a victim of human trafficking, as well as resources locally that help victims regain control of their life. And let me underscore the great work that Judge Herbert is doing in court. As a Director of Public Safety, I am very proud of the work of our Division of Police, what they've done on this issue, and their continued collaboration to work and curb this damaging criminal behavior. We welcome the input of counsel, the City Attorney's Office, and our many public and private partners as we continue to ramp up our efforts in the coming months and focus on new and effective tools to combat human trafficking. Please allow me now to introduce former commander of the Vice Squad, Commander Gary Cameron.
Thank you, Director Speaks. Before you proceed, Commander, I'm going to ask the members of the media to respect the anonymity of Sergeant Chrysler, if that's okay. Okay. Commander.
Chairperson Klein, thank you. And members of Council, I'm grateful for this opportunity to speak before you today and discuss the human trafficking problem in Central Ohio. During my career as a Columbus police officer, I have supervised the Columbus Vice Section twice, and from that experience, I can tell you with certainty that we have a problem, and it begins with men buying sex. For years, when I came on, the face of prostitution was the lone female walking the street corner of the sidewalk in the inner city, and she was looking to make a few dollars just to survive that day, just to make it by for that moment. Neighbors would call and complain, and the police would go out and they would arrest her. She'd get a night in jail and go right back out to the same street corner. And among the 1,500 plus arrests that we would make back in those years, some of those women would have 40 plus charges against them. We, the police, we were only pacifying the neighborhoods and rarely looked at prostitution as a critical community concern. But today is far different. We now know that women walking the street represent a very small portion of the women entrapped in prostitution. The largest group, and this is my number to it, perhaps 90%, are those young women forced into sex slavery by a pimp or a drug addiction, or likely both. Human trafficking today refers to those young women who are still a valuable commodity to their pimp. They're attractive, they're young, they're not so wasted on drugs where they could barely function. They're a commodity that can be sold to men who care not for our community, who only care about how much money it costs to have sex for a young-looking girl, sometimes teenagers. I've raised my daughters to be proud residents of the city of Columbus, and I can assure you that no daughter ever leaves childhood wanting to grow up to become a prostitute. And if that's true, if we can all agree on that being true, then somewhere along the line, our daughters fall prey to human trafficking and are truly victims. The victim was some guy, some sociopath, who thought it was okay. It was okay because there was no public outcry for the longest time. And if I only had a dollar for each time I've heard this lie, it's okay because prostitution's some victimless crime between consenting adults. And that's the biggest lie of them all, I believe. We can do better as a community. The Columbus Police Vice Section now has two new paradigms. And they are, until proven otherwise, females who we arrest are also victims in need of rescue. And the other is that the men who seek to pay for sex are a top law enforcement priority. Thank you.
Thank you, Commander Cameron. I'm gonna let Sergeant Chrysler and, is Lieutenant Kremling here too? No, just Sergeant Chrysler. I'm gonna let Sergeant Chrysler speak and then maybe have some questions for law enforcement and public safety generally.
Chairman Klein, Councilmember Hardin, thank you. if you'll direct your attention to the screen, I have a short PowerPoint presentation to give to kind of show the focus of the task force, where we have come from and why we have chosen the task force model to for law enforcement purposes in combating human trafficking. Early on, when we were just realizing that human trafficking was a problem and it stemmed much past the streetwalker and casual vice crimes, we looked deep into the law enforcement philosophy for vice and prostitution. And we realized that much of what we did was simply an arrest and incarcerate protocol. And it was just basically a cycle: arrest, go to court, incarceration, back out on the street. What we have chosen to do with regards to human trafficking is to incorporate a rescue philosophy where we do encounter prostitutes, and instead of treating them as a criminal, we treat them as a victim, as truly is what they are, as you've mentioned at the beginning, Chairman Klein, and it is very insightful. We seek to increase awareness, to train other law enforcement members, healthcare professionals, teachers and citizens, our protective services in our court, and we are very far along in that. We currently have quarterly meetings where we bring members of those various services together and we discuss where we're at, what victims we have brought forward, what services that we have offered, where we can move from there, where we have fallen short, and how we can move forward and succeed. Overcoming a lot of public awareness is teaching people that a pimp, a trafficker, the prostitution is not a humorous thing. It is not something that should be laughed at. A lot of people, especially older members of the community, when they think of pimp, they think of what you see here. They think of a parody. They think of something that's in a comedy sketch, something to be laughed at, something that's not harmful, that it's very humorous, and that couldn't be further from the truth. So in our solutions, we train and we work with our prosecutors. It is commonly referred to as the Chicago method, and that's where we seek out advice as we progress in our cases so that we can present the very best, the very most sound case that we can so that we can bring a prosecution and a conviction of these traffickers. We work with state and federal laws, state and federal prosecutors, because there are certain differences in the laws where proceeding through the state might benefit us more in a case, or proceeding federally might benefit us more, but we get together, we talk with the prosecutors, we present the facts that we have, investigators, we bounce ideas off each other, and we come up with the very best solution to bring the case to conclusion. But we also, while we're doing that, we work with social service agencies to assist the victims. And what is most important about this is we are a victim-centered task force. We are not a prosecution-centered task force. So if at any point when we rescue a young lady from internet trafficking, from street trafficking, just from the prostitution scene in general, if her concern is, hey, I'm out, but the idea of participating in a prosecution, the idea of testifying is way too much for me. I have other concerns. I have addiction. I have housing issues. I have no other means to support myself. These are the things that concern me most right now. there are avenues for them, and we provide them with the services, and we put them in the correct direction, as you will hear from other speakers later on. So with that in mind, it was important for us to bring together all the important factors. So we brought together the prosecutors, we brought together multiple agencies that have different databases, different avenues to reach out to the community, and we incorporated them into a task force so that we can share that information, share that intelligence. So what you have from our perspective is the Central Ohio Human Trafficking Task Force. And some of the members are presented there on the screen with their colors, the Columbus Division of Police, Homeland Security, we have the Delaware County Sheriff's Office, Ohio Highway Patrol, Bureau of Criminal Identification and Investigation, and the Powell Police Department. So when we're looking at the task force approach, a lot of what we want to get away from is what law enforcement and small communities are set up to do. They're set up to answer calls for services. They're set up for large crimes that really poke out of the media and really reach out and grab and put fear into people. The homicides, the crimes against persons, robberies, rapes, and assaults, the car break-ins, the things that really dig at people. We wanted to reach out past that. And not every law enforcement agency has a vice section. They don't have the necessary tools to reach into a more focused facet of criminal investigation and get away from the calls of service, to have the ability to work an undercover assignment and to strictly focus on prostitution on the internet, prostitution on the streets, and the interstate movement of these women. When you look at federal law enforcement alone, outside of the local agencies, a lot of their focus is on drugs or on larger scale crimes, organized crime, white collar crime, weapons violations, and especially terrorism. I mean, who among us doesn't want them working on terrorism? Those are very big topics, and we definitely want their attention drawn to that. But we do need them involved in this. So what we've done is, we use, currently on our task force, we use the Department of Homeland Security. We have two agents assigned to our task force. When we run into situations where we have a federal nexus, we have cross-state lines, we have juveniles that have been trafficked and we have identified their traffickers, we use them to present the cases to the federal prosecuting attorney. And when you look at that map, and I've reviewed this PowerPoint a couple of times in the past week, and you know, our country is very vast, and I am really at a loss to tell you which state on there we have not had contact with. I kind of poked fun at the Dakotas, and this past spring we actually had traffickers that left Columbus, Ohio, and went up into the Dakotas and stayed there for a number of weeks. Many of our cases, they start with a local crime. And it could be very simple. One particular case that we are currently working, a traffic violation exposed the traffickers and the juvenile that was in the car. Personally, in my past, the very first operation that I took part in brought me to a local hotel. There was a sting conducted by the task force that I wasn't a member with at the time, but what they ended up recovering was a 15-year-old and a 17-year-old from prostitution, and it was internet prostitution. Through luck, I was able to speak with one of the victims, and I asked her, why do you think we're here? Why do you think this is happening? Why do you think that you are with the police now? And she looked at me with a straight face, and she said, because of what we stole from the department store. Now, we had just removed her from a sex-for-hire operation. We stung her. We proved that she was there to have sex with a stranger for money. She was 15 years old. All she could think about was, we stole all this stuff from 10 Below. And it's all in the back of the car, and we're about ready to go to jail for that. It was not on her radar that what we were there for was for the soliciting. So again, a lot of our cases start with a local crime. Sometimes it wouldn't even be on our radar. We get a lot of calls from the Highway Patrol. We got a call this morning. We actually got two calls this morning. One was from a patrol unit on the south end of Columbus. They got called to Mount Carmel East on an assault, and the staff there, the medical staff, did not like the way a male was interacting with the victim. And it rose to the level where they escorted him off the property. But through awareness, through training, through just generally knowing this topic, because it's been in the news so much lately, they got the tag of the guy before he left. They called police, they brought him in. And after being interviewed with medical social services and with law enforcement personnel, it was revealed that she is a victim of human trafficking. And so we have begun our case.
Sergeant.
Yes.
Question. Are you aware of any training that hospital personnel do on their own, had the man not been there to raise the red flag? Do hospital personnel have any training or at least triage outside of the injury to determine whether the person that's being treated could be a victim of human trafficking?
Yes, they do. With respect to Mount Carmel East, I don't know exactly what that is, but I have taken part in training at Nationwide Children's Hospital where we have identified red flag indicators, and I believe that that's part of all triage at our medical facilities now. It is a very common practice. So with the task force, what we bring is we bring a task force multiplier. We share our databases and our resources together. So we share federal databases, we share state databases, our local, Columbus alone, with the amount of reports that we take, there's a vast amount of information that's available there. So when we bring them all together, we are able to paint a pretty vivid picture of the victims and the traffickers that we're dealing with. When it comes time for search warrants, we have access to local tactical teams. And in case of Columbus, we have our narcotics intact that does a lot of our drug search warrants. We have access to them. We have access to our SWAT team. With the state involved, we have access to BCI&I. We have access to the state troopers, who also have a SWAT team, and we also have Franklin County Sheriff's Office. So we are never at a loss for a bunch of very well-trained tactical guys to kick in a door for us. So our goal and our mission is to identify and rescue. Again, we are a victim-centered task force. Juvenile and adult victims of commercial sex exploitation are our number one target. We also are involved in the identification and rescue of labor trafficking victims. What's most important is once we have identified that we are dealing with a victim, again, we refer them to services. I don't want to speak too much on it because our Director of Professional Community Services, Michelle Hannon, will speak later, but we have a wonderful relationship with the Salvation Army, and I have to tell you, a lot of what we accomplish could not be done without those services. And that picture is for me. And I'll explain later as I roll past it. So again, speaking about our victim advocate and the Salvation Army, what we're able to do, we were able to link them up with health checkups, a safe place to stay, education, again, medical, dental, counseling is also very important. Clothing is often an issue, and we actually have the ability to bring a change of clothes with us when we go to operations and we encounter someone. And it is very important to change that environment as much as we possibly can and to create something new and something fresh and to prove to our victims that, you know, we are there to help and we are there to make their lives better. The history of the task force, we started in the late fall of 2011. I have zero tips for that point. We started from scratch. This was an issue where Columbus Vice Detective brought this to the attention of the Division of Police, who then reached out to Ohio Organized Crime and said, hey, look, this is an issue. We have seen this in our city. We would like to have the resources to come together and to combat this, and a task force was formed. By the next full year, we had generated 71 tips into human trafficking. As you can see, it has compounded from there. When I created this slide, it was back in June, so we are well above 100 tips. We're looking to be over 200 before the end of 2015. Where we receive our tips, we receive them from other police agencies across the state. We receive them from victims. A lot of times what we see is people who are actually in the trafficking situation. They may have never called for themselves, being an adult victim. But when they encounter a child that has been brought into that and they see them, it's just a shock to their consciousness, and they feel compelled to call out. And we usually recover both the child and the adult at the same time. It is not uncommon to have that scenario. And we do use informants. A lot of our informants come from the Narcotics Bureau. We also use the hotlines that are mentioned above. In this picture, this is very powerful, this young lady here. And for those of you that can't read it at the top, it says, children don't wake up one morning and decide that they'll be prostitutes. They are forced into it. And that is very true. And it is part of educating the public and part of being a progressive society and bringing attention that there is a lot of trauma behind this. There is a lot of physical abuse, a lot of mental abuse. This is a person that is in crisis when you see these young ladies, even as adults, as children. It's not something that is just casual. It is never casual. And I think that it should shock the conscience of people to see this because, you know, I get a lot of comments, well, they don't have to do that. That is a choice that they're making. They don't have to do that. And that is just someone that just either refuses to acknowledge or just hasn't had the opportunity to be educated. But from my perspective and from the perspective of the people that will share with you here shortly, there's a lot that's taking from these people early on, a lot of things that we take for granted. There's a lot of trauma that's brought in that completely camouflages what we view as normalcy is. They have no idea what normal life is. We have no idea what they've seen and what they've experienced that would create this type of horrific environment to seem normal. And what's even worse is as they become adults and they see how the rest of society interacts, there's shame. And that also prevents them from coming forward. And it should shock people as much as this next slide, because it is no different. When you have a child that's endured trauma that leads them to become a teenager, an adult, and to go into the prostitution trade and be forced into that, it is the same as these children that are trained to kill and to be warriors and to be child soldiers. It's because they don't know any different. They've had some evil in life come to them and present something completely different to them at a young age and completely distort reality. And that's when you get them going down this path to something that's completely horrific. A majority of our cases are long-term. These often take they mirror career criminal cases. 4 months is extremely short. One case that made headlines recently was our massage parlors in Powell and in Columbus. That actually was a very short investigation, and it started in October of 2014, and we served our search warrants in January. But that was very difficult to do. And we were dealing with a small community that they were not going to sit and wait for us to stretch out the investigation. As much as we pleaded, as much as we said, hey, look, we got a lot more to look into this. This is not just you. This stretches out into Columbus. This stretches out into Westerville. We had a lot of push, but we were provided the resources, and we were able to pull it off, and we were very successful. So again, right below that, it does require a large amount of resources. And the importance of this is the Ohio Organized Crime Task Force that provides our structure, that provides a lot of our funding and a lot of our equipment and our resources. Again, the complexity of these cases reach out to the fact that we have multiple victims. It is very rare to encounter one prostitute, discover that she is a victim of trafficking, and have her be the sole victim. I can't think of one now sitting before you where that's been the case. These have always reached out and touched other lives. There's always been multiple suspects. There's always been multiple crimes involved, and it is very much laid out next to that there is human trafficking, but it involves prostitution, almost always involves narcotics. There is some form of money laundering being involved, and there's usually violence upon the victims, whether it be assault, whether it be a form of kidnapping or abduction, their freedom. They cannot leave. They are not free to go. These are some of the investigative techniques. These things involved are a covert interaction with a prostitute to see, you know, what we are dealing with. That's usually where it starts. And then we develop electronic intelligence, move on to surveillance, serve subpoenas to look at records, and then react with search warrants. And sometimes it involves wiretaps, which are very, very labor intensive and take a while. So have you heard of us? Have you heard our work that's being done? And sometimes people haven't. They're like, we don't even hear about the task force. We don't know what they're doing. But as in today, I don't get in front of the media. My agents don't get in front of the media. We don't do press releases. We do it through the agencies that we represent. So when you hear that federal agents has made an arrest in human trafficking, that is our task force. So these are some of the high profile cases that we've done. This is one of the first ones, and we got 18 months out of it, and we weren't very pleased with that. But this was one of the very first human trafficking cases that we brought through the courts. And shortly thereafter, we came up with David Nelms, and he received a 12-year conviction. That was a very, very long investigation. It involved a lot of victims. I think we had 6 different victims, and 3 of them have since passed away. So it's very personal to us. You know, we keep track of these young ladies. We know when something has happened to them. We know when they haven't been able to escape the lifestyle. This is Valerio Alexander, and we were able to get him a 15-year conviction, and he was trafficking juveniles. This is a father-son team. This is the Erics. The man on top is the son. Both Keith Eric Jr. and Senior. Senior was convicted 15 years. Junior got 10 years because he actually testified against his father. I watched Keith Eric Jr. walk out of the hotel right after we conducted a sting. I had no idea who he was. And once we developed it and I recognized that, I watched him walk out, it was very chilling and it became very personal to me to get him locked up. More recently, and you know, this is just public awareness. This is just education. We had a jury that they agreed at the time that he was interacting with this young lady, she was a juvenile. And they agreed that while he was interacting with her, he created child pornography with that juvenile. They agreed on that. They had no problem with that. He is at least looking at a minimum of 15 years. He's not been sentenced yet. What they couldn't agree on is whether or not he was an active participant in her prostituting herself out as a 16 and then eventually a 17-year-old when we encountered her. And I don't have an answer for that. Our prosecutors do not have. We are all troubled by that loss, that we weren't able to pull that off. That is a big problem. But that is something that we hope to solve through education, through getting the word out to the public about what we're doing, what it looks like, what these people are doing, these young ladies. How he was able to exert his control over another human being and exact his will on her, and she carried it out. They felt like she could leave at any time, that she really wasn't under force by him. Again, Columbus man pleads guilty in federal court to gun and prostitution charges. This is Carl Smith. When the intact team went into his apartment, he had a fully automatic AK-47 within 5 feet of him. There were narcotics in the room. He is an incredibly violent man. To go back to the comedic picture of what a pimp is, and that it's all silk shirts and flashy suits and a lot of humor. It is not like that at all. It is very violent and it is very dangerous. These are dangerous individuals. Most recently, aspiring rapper Eric Chavez was arrested, and we are currently waiting trial on this. I think we just wrapped up grand jury on him, so that is a very fresh case. I won't get into that a lot, but again, when you see these things, this is our task force. This is us at work. Reynoldsburg, this originally was charged as a domestic violence. They had a third-party female in the home with them that they were abusing, and the patrol officers really didn't know what they were looking at. They know that she had been harmed. They know that she lived with these people. They charged them with domestic violence, and then after looking further into it, they said, you know what, this doesn't look right, and they reached out to us. And we were able to put one of our agents in with their detectives, and through a lengthy investigation, we found that there was much more to it, and we were able to bring charges of human trafficking and probably slew 5-6 other charges. There were a lot of major felonies were leveled against these two individuals, and a lot of it was on camera. There's a lot of footage of horrific things being done to this lady. This is another one of our cases. This is another 2015 case that just recently hit the news. Right before we locked him up, the day before we locked him up, and what caused us to move is we had one of our victims who had been ignoring us, and we kept track of her. We'd call her, we'd leave messages, we would have our victim advocate call her just to prove to her, hey, look, you know, we're here for you. Whenever you feel that it's time to step out and to do something for yourself, we are there for you. She made a phone call to us after dealing with patrol, and she said, look, this guy chased me all over Weber Road with a gun and tried to pin me between two cars with his. He is going to kill me. We got her out of that situation. We executed a search warrant the next day, and we locked him up, and he's been incarcerated ever since. So when we do have a victim come forward, we are able to act quickly. And again, this is the massage parlor. For those of you that didn't catch it, it was very highly publicized, and we had 15 counts, very heavy federal charges, or state charges leveled against three people. And again, I have no idea why the husband was not convicted. That escapes me, but the two women that were in charge of the massage parlor were convicted on all 15 counts that we leveled against them, and that includes human trafficking specs. So we are very effective. We are very successful. A lot of that has to do with our ability to work with services, ability to work with the courts, ability to work with prosecutors. It is very much a joint effort. And these are just the last slide is just for the audience for the different tip lines that we use as a way to get in front of us. And when I speak to different neighborhoods, block watches, 911 is a fantastic way to get a hold of us. If anybody can't remember any of these tip lines, 911 will find us. That is not an issue. Our dispatchers are trained. They know who to call. They know where to reach us. And that concludes my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Sergeant. Can you or Commander Cameron talk about what you're doing to the Johns and the type of stings and operations you're running for the Johns that are participating and paying for sex with these victims?
Would you like me to speak, sir? Currently, the Vice Unit with Columbus Police, they have, in fact, this has been going on for several years, starting in 2013. They noticed, and in fact, it was brought to our attention by Chief Jacobs, that we had a disparaging number of females, when compared to males, convicted of crimes in the Vice Investigative Bureau. So if we had 700, 800 female charged with soliciting the equivalent, and we didn't have a way to track whether it was actually an exposer in a park or a John, I think the number in 2012 was maybe 50. I mean, it was awful. That was brought to our attention, and we immediately made changes. The very next year, we changed 50 to 250. That was in 13. 14, we were able to almost break 300, and currently this year, in August, we have made, I believe, 371 arrests of males for soliciting for prostitution, specifically. The reason why it hadn't been, we hadn't pursued it before is it was very labor intensive. In order to protect a female police officer working undercover in that capacity required a large amount of officers for safety, for arrest, for processing the prisoner out. But we have found a way through technology, through staffing, to make it a basically a one decoy, six safety officer team. We have very good electronics to bring evidence to court with us. And we also, what ends up happening in court is there's what's called a John school that is offered to them. And we've discussed offering different services similar to that for prostitutes who have encountered their first arrest, their first encounter with vice, their first introduction to the court system. So we are progressing forward in offering that to women. But right now in the John School, they are spoken to about basically how they are re-victimizing these girls, how they are participating in this and how awful it is. Anything from that to diseases to actually speaking to a victim, hearing from a victim of human trafficking, seeing how that has impacted them. And I can't speak to numbers, but I think the recidivism rate is very, very low for men that go through that school.
Thank you, Sergeant. Commander, do you?
Chairman Klein, thank you. If I could just clean up a few things there that and add to what Sergeant Chrysler said. Early on in 2014, Chief Jacobs and I discussed this issue, and it was part of further discussions regarding the task force and how we could assign personnel to the Human Trafficking Task Force. And at that time, she recognized clearly that there was a problem. And so over the course of time, we've been successful in getting her approval to assign administratively at times female officers to the vice section so we could have a better balance of those who we arrest. We have ordered the vice section supervisors to conduct, and sometimes monthly, if not bi-monthly, decoy operations. And the problem has always been a matter of resources. To run a decoy operation, like the sergeant said, it takes quite a few officers, sometimes 6, 8, 10 officers at a time, where it's, if you go to the reverse route where you focus on females, it could just be 2 officers out there in their playing cars. And so we, at times, I guess, took the path of least resistance and just went out there and focused on the females. And now we're forcing upon the vice section to now focus more on males. And so you're seeing more arrests. In 2014, there were 300 plus men arrested for soliciting by our vice section. And I think I heard the sergeant say that we're at 300 now plus, and we still have quite a few months to go. And he's right, we do work closely with the court system. We try to work as closely as we can, if not incredibly close, with Catch Court. So every female we arrest, we're putting a pamphlet in her hand on Catch Court, and we actually have officers who go to John Court or John School and teach. And so we're actively involved in that as well.
Thank you, Commander. Because, I mean, obviously this is a demand-driven problem. And if the men are driving the demand and they're the problem that causes trafficking, it's encouraging that CPD has turned resources on identifying the men who are participating and demanding the sex for money to help eliminate the demand and hold, or to the extent that you can eliminate the demand and hold those folks accountable. So that's encouraging news, at least from my opinion, my standpoint, that resources are being diverted, because as I said at the beginning, you know, to treat the women like criminals and simply arrest them doesn't do anything but perpetuate the problem. And I think that's a great segue to turn it over to our international expert, who's critically acclaimed and loves the praise that he gets every single day and bathes in the sunlight. Judge Paul Herbert.
I hate you. Councilmember Klein, thank you very much for listening to all of us tonight. It's quite an honor to be here with these folks who I've had the chance to get to know almost all of them over the years and work with them. And I can tell you that this is the highest quality group of people that I think I've run across in my travels that putting their minds together is really, really cool to see. It's really an honor to be here with them tonight on this such a great occasion. I want to thank City Council for taking a chance on us. Back in 2009, we had this experiment that we wanted to start called Catch Court, and we came up and you guys took a chance on us along with, you matched funds with the county commissioners as well. And that was just, in my mind, to start a court that would try to get at the issue of the recidivism rate within just the prostitution community. We started that not really knowing where it would go, but we're happy to say that there was a grant by Franklin University that did an independent study of the results of Catch Court for the last 5 years. And the results are kind of indicating what all you guys are saying here tonight and that all you guys knew. So it's really cool to see the numbers speak for that. And that is, of all the women that have been accepted into the Catch Court program over the last 5 years, 72% of them have not had another charge, let alone a jail night or any of the other problems that we're seeing, that we've seen for thousands of years with this population. And I can only say that that speaks to the fact that they don't want to be doing this, they don't want in this, they hate it, and they're looking for any way out. And I'm glad that City Council and the police and everybody else in this audience here tonight has supported us in recognizing this issue, so, and that allows us to do the work that my incredible staff is doing down there every day. Got a great staff, along with treatment partners in the community. We're really forging some new protocols that make treatment a viable option for this population when people thought there was no solution to this problem. So it's been really exciting to see everybody kind of pioneer, to be quite honest with you, and that our court is being replicated in Cincinnati, in Dayton, in Cleveland, Franklin County Juvenile, and it's just really in across the country in various places. So I also want to thank Chief Jacobs and Commander Cameron. I remember Commander Cameron when he just started in the Vice Squad, and I came out there, and he thought I was crazy, I think, but he let me talk to the guys, and he listened, and the chief listened, and now they are responsible for widespread changes in the way the Columbus Police Department think about women who are on the street, and I've seen it happen, and it's really neat, and I think you need to be commended that you are in charge of supporting such a fine police department that's becoming a leader in the nation on this issue. So thank you for supports for them. We also work with Rick Pfeiffer. He was one of the first guys I went to with this, and I think he got it faster than I did. I said, hey, I want to start this. He goes, I'm on board 100%. So their office has been phenomenal since the beginning, and I know you'll hear a little bit more from them and one of their special employees in just a minute. Now, when I first started the Catch Court, I would have said that I thought that prostitution was the world's oldest profession. Those were the words that would have come out of my mouth. But now I'm saying that prostitution is really the most misunderstood criminal enterprise in our country. And you saw a little bit of it up there on the slide from the sergeant, but he's absolutely right. And my brain has been expanding because I just got off the phone with a common police court judge last week where I said, hey, you've got warrants out for a woman that we have up here in Columbus who's charged with soliciting, but you've got her for all these felonies. I think she's a human trafficking victim, and I want to give her treatment. Can you release the warrants? And he goes, oh, my gosh, you don't even know, Herbert. And I said, what do you mean I don't know? She was charged with a pattern of corrupt activity, identity theft, larceny, a whole bunch of stuff. And he said, the truth behind this is there's a woman trafficker who's making them go out and sell themselves, and then when they sell themselves, she makes them take the guy's credit card and bring it back to me, and then we run the credit card up. Sometimes they'll take his automobile. He rarely is reporting this to the police because he doesn't want to get caught. And so what you're dealing with is not just a prostitution issue. This is a criminal justice issue. And so I want us to start thinking broader than that. It even we in Catch Court now accept any crime where a woman has been put through this and she's facing this issue, she can now get help and get out, which is really very progressive. We have the most progressive municipal judges, I think, in the state of Ohio. They've allowed me to do this and they've supported me, and so along with the judges and our great staff, it's been neat. It's still on me to get better training to our judges and our attorneys that work in that court. I've learned so much, and it's kind of been experiential. Now I'm starting to learn more. When you have a defendant in front of you, sometimes she'll be aggressive towards you. Sometimes she'll be never look you in the eye. Sometimes she'll be downright disrespectful or not talk at all. And as a traditional former prosecutor and judge for 12 years, I'd look at that and say, man, I got to put the hammer down. I got to teach that person a lesson. When in reality, now I know that people that are in front of you that are victims of human trafficking don't have the same kind of coping mechanisms that the rest of our citizens might have because of what they've been through. So if our judges and attorneys that represent them and our prosecutors that are prosecuting them can look at this person and say, yeah, they have this record, they have this situation, they're exhibiting the signs of trauma, let's move forward toward a trauma-informed court. And Paige Allen is the director of all of our specialty dockets. She's here. She actually brought that to my attention. She's got a way, a method of bringing our court to more trauma-informed. So I respect her for her diligence in this area. I will tell you, I guess the police left this out, the task force and their officers need more resources. I'll just tell you this, that you know, you've got guys in the Human Trafficking Task Force with piles of files all over their desks with cases that can't get work because there's only a couple of them. They've got enough work, and I also am going to propose tonight that challenge the police on the next level, like I'm going to challenge everyone, that what we need to do is have an interdisciplinary police response to this. Why isn't the Human Trafficking Task Force working with the Crimes Against Children Task Force? They're one and the same. You're creating one problem and ignoring it on the other hand. So I think that if we could look at this thing holistically, if not just from the courts, but the police and some other areas as well. That's just one big area. I'm in the exit strategy. We're allowing women to get out, but there's something that I think we ought to start here, and I guess it starts at the top, wherever that is, and that's an in-demand campaign. We got Michelle Hannon. She's going to talk later. I don't know if she's going to talk about this tonight, but she's a brilliant woman from the Salvation Army. She runs the Central Ohio Rescue and Restore Coalition. She's spreading that throughout Ohio. She's designed an in-demand campaign that we could implement very quickly here in Columbus, Ohio, that would let people know, if you want to arrest a woman or a girl in Columbus, Ohio, you're going to jail. Let that word get out on the internet. Let people know, you come to Columbus, Ohio, that's what's going to happen to you. We need to stand up and protect our women and girls. That's what I believe. You've been good at listening to us and strengthening our resources. And I also want to say, you know, it sounds to me like 99% of this winds up in the courts. You talk about, no matter what you talk about, he even talked about the Nelms case. One of the surviving victims of the Nelms case at the same time the Nelms case was going on was being treated and triaged through catch court. So, you know, you got a victim on the one hand being treated like a defendant, but restored through a rehabilitative justice system. We're saving lives, we're saving money. I'm seeing multi-generational healing going on, saving jail costs, and these women are brilliant. They're going to college, getting degrees with like order of the coif type levels, something I would never even understand. And they're really becoming great citizens that are giving back. We've got several of them that work for Alva's House now as peer mentors for women who are coming through the program. We've got others who are now in college getting a chemical dependency degree, and we have them as interns in our drug court. So it's really cool to see how mobilizing of a community they can be. They're amazing. And I appreciate everybody in this room and your incredible support for what we do down there at court. It takes a community of support, and you guys are giving that to us. I really am humbled by that. And just thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight.
Thank you, Judge. Talk to me about catch court. How does someone end up in catch court? Because not every woman that's brought to the criminal justice system is in catch court.
Right.
So how is that figured out? How's that triaged?
There's several different ways. The kind of the more well-known way is if you're charged with prostitution, you come down. Commander Cameron is right. Right now, they give you a complaint in one hand, they give you a catch court brochure in the other hand, and they say this is your way out. And then the women can come to court asking for that. The public defenders can offer that as well. But now we're seeing a whole population of women that, for instance, maybe they're charged with a drug offense, and they're in drug court, and no one really knows how they got there, that they have a background of human trafficking and soliciting. Maybe they're dancing in a club. They got caught. We have one woman who got caught with an OVI, and she was coming from a dance club. We found out all the things that were going on behind that scene. And so she was in catch court on a totally non-commercial sex-related basis. So basically, they have to go through some pretty rigorous assessments, however, to see whether or not they're in the right mind frame to change, and then to see what their trauma has been, and then to see how patient they can be with the process. I firmly believe it takes 2 years. Our program is 2 years in length. There's different models in the country, and we've actually started to adopt parts of the shorter version, which Sergeant Chrysler was talking about, offering women a 3-day class that aren't ready for the big 2-year commitment. That's being very successful right now. It's also really neat to work with the police when they have a victim and they want to try to get help for her, and the only way they can do that is to wrap the resources around that all you guys in this room are offering. Through the Salvation Army, through the court system, through the prosecutor's office. It's been, you know, just a great pleasure of mine. So thank you.
And Judge, and this is, if you can't answer this question, I can certainly, Commander Cameron or Sergeant Chrysler could answer as well. What percentage of women that are arrested for prostitution end up in catch?
Oh, not very many. You have 1,500 women arrested a year, and I'd say 1% of them wind up in catch.
1%?
Just 1% wind up in catch that are arrested. I can't tell you. I thought you were going to serve me a softball.
Well, you look like I was going to ask you a great question. So what was that question I should have been asking?
I thought you were going to throw me a softball instead of that hard one, but... I got tired of people saying, hey, who are the prostitutes? Who are the human trafficking victims? Why are you helping these people and not helping these people? Even though I kind of see them all as one, to be honest with you. They're vulnerable women in my community that I want to serve and protect. They need help. So we developed with a think tank out of Washington, D.C., a human trafficking assessment tool. And I said, give every woman charged with prostitution that assessment that comes through catch court. So we did a sample of that, and 92% of women charged with prostitution also fall under the definition of human trafficking victims in Ohio. So if you just do the easy math and say we have 1,000 women arrested every year for prostitution, that's 920 of them are actually going to fall out in the victim category of Ohio's statute. That's a lot more than I think anybody ever realized, because they think it's, you know, in some, it involves some kids, you know, from a foreign country that are locked up, like the movie Taken. It's really not that at all.
So clearly the 1% that come to you, 72% of those folks end up in the positive direction.
Exactly. Sorry.
So that basically leaves 1,470 plus people that don't.
Right.
What can we do about the 1,470? I know that's a tough question, because clearly the ones that are in catch are, they're I don't want to say they're doing great, but their lives are drastically changed for the better.
That's all what Michelle's going to talk about.
Oh, okay.
Well, what I would say just from the court's perspective, and Michelle's a tremendous asset on this, I would say short term, and Vanessa can also speak to this, but a woman's not, she's ready at a certain point. And until she gets to that point, whatever that life crisis is that finally gets her to the point where she says, I want to change, we can't really help them. But Michelle's probably going to go further into the prevention. We need to have programs for our young girls. Last night I was speaking to a group of middle school kids and said, hey, how many of you guys heard a kick? All their hands shot right up. All their parents' hands stayed down. And that's where the traffickers are reaching out now in this new thing called KICK. They're reaching out and recruiting them off of there. So we need to get this, we need to be active in preventing this from our young kids. And then 10 years from now, Councilmember Klein, you'll see a much lower result.
And what percentage do you think have drug dependency issues?
99.9%.
Because One of the common themes that I hear when I'm out in the public is the quality of life issues for the neighborhoods and prostitution in their neighborhoods, and for the women that aren't ready for catch. Like, what are we doing to solve that quality of life issue, not only for the victim's quality of life, but for neighborhood improvement for all neighborhoods in the city of Columbus? Because if we're simply locking or arresting women, they go to jail for a night or two, 99.9% of them are chemically dependent.
Right.
They have significant issues with drug dependency, clearly. They just get back out on the street, and then they're back out in a neighborhood demeaning the quality of life in the neighborhood.
Yeah. And it's a perpetual drain on very limited resources. You get neighborhood decline, you got increased costs. I ran the numbers with some help of Commander Cameron, and some other folks. And in 2006, Franklin County was spending $5.4 million a year to arrest and jail their prostitutes. That's if we continue to do nothing, we're gonna spend $5 million a year. I think Catch Court costs around $200,000 a year to run. Now, we're dealing with small numbers, you know. We're dealing with that 100 women a year. But maybe it's time to start looking at those somethings of scale, whatever you call that. What's that term? Economies of scale, Gary, is that it? And start to change those, and maybe you'll see a change in that number. I don't know. Sounds good.
Thank you, Judge. I always reserve questions to come back as they pop in my mind. So, okay. Judge, if that's okay.
Yeah, that's fine.
So I'm going to turn it over to Ms. Murray, Ann Murray, from the Columbus City Attorney's Office.
Thank you, Chairman Klein. I'm going to just speak briefly about some of the services that our office offers victims generally. I think there's a very close analogy between domestic violence victims, which is the unit that I oversee, and human trafficking victims. The amount of control over the victims' lives that make certain decisions inevitable, I think, in many situations. One of the things that we see with domestic violence victims is that it's not that they stay necessarily, they leave, they go back. And so sometimes in domestic violence, it takes 5 to 7 times of leaving and going back to before they're able to make a decision and before they're able to find safety measures. But we also know that when they leave, that is one of the most dangerous times. And so what I'm encouraged to see is that it appears in our community, one, that we're seeing the victims being treated as victims and victims of trauma. And that is very common with victims of domestic violence. And one of the things that we see as well with our services is that prosecution of offenders goes up when the victims are treated with advocacy services, the sooner the better. And I know that the Salvation Army is very well thought of, and they do a very good job of that. I know the Columbus Police is really working to work closely with advocates, but that's one of the things that I would ask of the council to consider, is really boning up on the advocacy services for victims throughout the investigation and throughout the case, because there is this continuation of behavior and life that goes on. The relationship with the pimp or whomever is doing it, the madam. And that is what can interfere greatly in any intervention, is if there is this witness intimidation is what I would call it as a prosecutor. But one of the things that we see, again, is this relationship, it builds up, it clouds the way that somebody thinks. One of the things I learned the other day is that Charles Manson actually studied pimps to be able to figure out how to get people under his control, because he was so enamored of how they were able to get somebody to behave completely the way that he wanted to, and he was ultimately successful. That is what we see when we see batterers, and when we see batterers who are pimping out their partners. So we are successful sometimes in getting people away from those very dangerous situations, but it's not an easy fix. It does take extensive resources in terms of reaching that victim to counterbalance the mental focus that has been given to them by this offender. So again, what our office does is we offer strong advocacy services. When we do find that somebody has been trafficked or we suspect, we will both reach out to the counselors that are available in Catch Court as well as the Salvation Army, and they are both tremendous resources. I know several years ago we talked to the sergeants that were and detectives that were in CPD's human trafficking squad, and that one of the things they asked for was an advocate, if there's any way that we could get an advocate to work with the victims during the ongoing investigations, because it is so easy for them to become frightened and go back, and it takes a lot of time to go through. So thank you for your attention to this issue and to really putting the focus on that the victims of human trafficking really are victims and that we need to change the way that we're doing things in Columbus.
Thank you, Ms. Murray, I appreciate that. The next speaker is Amy O'Grady, Assistant Section Chief over at Attorney General Mike DeWine's office. So thank you for coming, Ms. O'Grady, appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair Klein, you know, for allowing me to speak on the efforts that we're working on in Mike DeWine's office with regard to human trafficking and how we specifically work with officials here in Columbus and in Franklin County. You know, you've heard about the Central Ohio Human Trafficking Task Force, you know, that was created by the Organized Crime Commission that's chaired by Mr. DeWine. And, you know, I just want to again thank the Columbus Police Department, you know, particularly Commander Cameron and Chief Jacobs and Sergeant Chrysler. I mean, working with this office has been tremendous. And the amount of support that they give back to us, he, you know, Sergeant Chrysler was very nice in his support of the OCIC, but boy, we get it tenfold in return, so we're very thankful. You also hear from Michelle Hannon, you know, after me, but I did want to mention that we're also thankful not only for Michelle's work on the law enforcement end, but also the policy end. We get a lot of support from her through our Human Trafficking Commission, and I'd like to address the commission a couple of general issues and just some things, as I mentioned, for you to think about from a statewide perspective that we see, you know, through Mike DeWine's office. So, you know, in starting with the commission, you know, as Director Speaks indicated, it, you know, was certainly reconvened by Mr. DeWine after, you know, was started by Mr. Cordray, you know, to serve as a network for coalitions, law enforcement, and service providers around the state. I've brought copies of our annual report for, you know, you, Chair Klein, and anyone in the office and here today that would like to review it. We also have some palm cards, both in English and Spanish, that you can take as well as leave here at City Council. You know, through this commission, we provided assistance with legislation, including the Safe Harbor and End Demand Acts. You know, but one of the things that I'll tell you, we have Veronica Scherbauer here. She's here in the front row. And I'm very pleased with her efforts to involve businesses. And let me give you an example. In our last Human Trafficking Commission meeting, we had a local, you know, a hotel that's a national chain who has a hotel here in Columbus that, you know, had talked with us and shared that they think they may have seen some things that involved trafficking, but they weren't sure. But they were thankful to have us because, you know, reach out to them because they want to now have some training. So we're working with their director of security. You know, we've involved banks, you know, because, you know, of the need for, you know, the exchange of money and just the need for making sure that they're, you know, looking out for things that may seem a little suspect. We talked about travel centers and trucking agencies. We've worked with the State Highway Patrol and Truckers Against Trafficking to start to look at what we can do to partner with that nonprofit here in Ohio. So it's just a really good avenue for both the enforcement and the policy and for folks to network and see what's going on in the state. You know, and I would encourage anyone here, if you haven't been to a commission meeting, to, you know, please, you know, feel comfortable coming. You know, we mentioned legislation and, you know, we work with Representative Fetter on, you know, through our commission on both of those, you know, key bills that she put forth, the Safe Harbor and End Demand Act. And, you know, just for your knowledge, you know, there are a couple of organizations, that being Shared Hope and the Polaris Project, that look at the states and, you know, give them an eye, you know, give the a bird's eye view about some things that we're doing right and some things that we can maybe have some improvement on. So we look a lot at legislation at the, you know, at the state level to see what we can do to get some good examples and, you know, maybe make some positive changes. It wasn't mentioned earlier, but our Central Ohio Human Trafficking Task Force also partners with two local prosecutor's offices. One is Franklin County and one is Delaware. So in addition to the prosecution efforts, we also explore ways to look at that legislation. You know, so we talk about those human experiences you can give the legislature about things that we maybe could have gone forward on with regard to state law, but couldn't happen because of the way the law is currently stated. Let me give you a really common theme of something that we see a lot. So the way the current trafficking in persons law is written, if you're a minor under the age of 16, you don't need to prove compulsion, just only that that minor is engaged in that commercial sex act. You know, however, when it's 16 to 17 year olds, you have to prove that the victim was compelled to engage in commercial sex activity unless a trafficker is in a position of authority over the victim, you know, such as being a parent or guardian. So it's not exactly in line with federal law, and that's why, you know, when Sergeant Chrysler was talking about where to take cases and what to do, you know, these are some things that they think about. You know, and we've had some cases, you know, very recently where we had 16 or 17 year olds that may have gone down some different paths because of the way that the law is currently written. So when you're thinking about things that you can take from this hearing, one thing that we're doing in Mike DeWine's office is looking at legislation, and if you would like to think more about or support in any way, we would very much love that endeavor. You know, I want to talk about a couple of sections in our office that are key that look at human trafficking, and one is the Crime Victim Services section. You know, during the 2015 grant year, a total of 340,000 roughly in change, you know, were awarded to four agencies serving victims of human trafficking statewide. You know, we look at our youth, you know, because they're particularly vulnerable when it comes to human trafficking. And, you know, I can tell you about two good programs here in Columbus that received VOCA funding, particularly to help out with, you know, with youth here in Columbus. That's the Huckleberry House and Star House. You know, they provide, Huckleberry House, for example, provides services to runaway homeless and street youth, and they've been doing that since 1971. You know, we have Star House that serves as a drop-in center for street youth living in Central Ohio. So we will continue to work with and look at those programs that are providing that assistance. But getting back to legislation and a little bit of programming, I want to bring up our Victims of Crime Compensation Program. That program was developed to help innocent victims of violent crime. You know, and there are exclusions to the rules such as having a felony conviction within 10 years of the crime or having a felony drug in your system, you know, at the time of the crime. You know, the law was changed a few years ago to address minor victims of human trafficking. And it said that if those exclusions would somehow have knocked them out otherwise, you know, it would mean that human trafficking, minor human trafficking victim could still receive crime victims' money. But here's the issue to think about. You know, when you consult with our section chief in Crime Victim Services, you know, and we've talked with Michelle Hannon and other victim service providers in the prosecutor's offices and said, please flood us with your applications. You know, sometimes it's an effort that honestly can result in nothing. And, you know, when I say nothing, I mean a denial of the claim. It, you know, our folks, if we can't help in our Crime Victim Services section, we certainly do our best to refer you to other local services that can help. But if we're in a position where we can use some of that money from the Crime Victims Fund to assist a needed person with some counseling, you know, or other expenses that may be eligible under the fund, we would like to do that. Under the current state of the law, there are certainly limitations. I'll get to OPATA training. You know, there was a change back in 2011 that mandated human trafficking training for law enforcement and basic training. It's a 12-hour course. You know, Mr. DeWine has indicated that he'd like, you know, next year to also include, as part of the continuing professional training requirements, some human trafficking training as well. So we're trying to, again, you know, as much as we can, make sure that officers who haven't taken our courses or a comparable course have that training. You know, I just want to get back to, you know, again, some things for you to think about. You know, we get calls on a regular basis from other states about your Central Ohio Human Trafficking Task Force here in Columbus. You know, particularly two states were calling to find out what they can do to emulate those efforts. You know, Corsi has reported, you know, there is Central Ohio Rescue and Restore Coalition, which Michelle will tell you about, getting a number of calls, you know, a month, around 30 a month as of this year, and Michelle will probably, you know, help me with those numbers, but roughly. As Sergeant Chrysler has indicated, your tips, from just the task force alone are going to reach 200 or above. And those cases take time and effort. So it's just something to think about. It's while you are a model in the model that other states are looking at, anything that you can do to keep that in the forefront is so worthwhile. And we would love to hear any ideas that you may have to help our office and Mr. DeWine collaborate with you. Judge Herbert talked about, his efforts in the court. Housing. If you take anything from needs on services, counseling absolutely exists, but boy, hearing about what it takes for something like a Grace Haven or other avenues for people just to have access to housing when they're in that state, and Sergeant Chrysler's doing his good work, and he captures, and rescues that survivor, they need somewhere to go. And that's something that you can think about. When Michelle gets into her public awareness event, I'm telling you, we got such a reaction out of businesses that it's really, again, something you should think about, because if they don't know what's going on, they should. And if they do know what's going on, they have no idea what to do about it. There is a law that I'll mention that's a statewide reporting law about trafficking. And state agencies, as well as prosecutor's offices, are required to report cases involving human trafficking. Last year, I think we got about 3. Now, again, your Central Ohio Human Trafficking Task Force, Franklin County Prosecutor's Office, Delaware County Prosecutor's Office, they just worked on a huge case. And, those are things that, we need to hear about and want to hear about, because even though it's not that trafficking in person's charge, it's still something that, again, if it's out in the public, can get awareness out about the issue. But I'd say if I had to ask you of anything, it would be to really think about what you've heard a little about from Judge Herbert today, and that's the overlap. This hearing on human trafficking is beyond important, and again, I commend you for doing it. But boy, think about this in the broader scale. We've got an overdose task force that, up in Toledo that looks at cases where there are non-fatal overdoses. And they called me and they said, Amy, we're starting to hear a lot about the fact that when these people come in the hospital, they're trafficking victims. What can we do to get trafficking, training? We want this to happen. I wanted to jump for joy. There are so many avenues that people say, we need money for mental health, we need money for trafficking, we need money for this, that. Think about it collectively, because it happens. You've got some efforts here locally in the county. I know the sheriff's office is looking into maybe doing some of what Toledo is doing. I strongly encourage them, Columbus, anybody that will listen about the overlap, because if you can tout that in addition to your nationally recognized judge as well as your task force, oh my goodness, the sky's the limit. Thank you so much again for your time.
Thank you so much, Ms. O'Grady. Just to clarify a couple things that you said, that I have some questions about. On the crime victim compensation and the reimbursement,
yeah.
You mentioned that there were exceptions.
Correct.
And they, if I understood you correctly, that crime victims may not be eligible for compensation if they have previous felony experience, maybe you said past 10 years, and or evidence of some sort of narcotic or drug in their system.
So there's a list in, this, mm-hmm. in the revised code that talks about if you have A through E going on at the time of the crime itself, you're ineligible for crime victims compensation.
What's the exception? Is it just limited to juveniles or all victims of human trafficking?
Exception to human trafficking is just limited to juveniles.
Okay. That doesn't make any sense to me, because if you're treating the women as victims, limiting it to just juvenile victims seems to be lacking common sense, especially when the example that Judge Herbert gave of calling a common pleas court judge saying that someone clearly who was engaged in criminal enterprise but ended up likely being someone who's a victim of human trafficking, if she would get convicted on those charges, probably wouldn't be eligible to receive victim compensation because of felony prosecution for something that she was coerced into, which is why we're calling them a victim. So that maybe is something that we need to advocate for on the state level. The next is, and you didn't mention this, but is there sexual offender registration for human trafficking criminals, or is it just limited to human trafficking criminals that are engaged with juveniles?
be honest with you, I'm not sure.
Okay. Yeah. Does anyone, do you know Judge Herbert?
I think, yeah, they have to report. Oh, sorry, yeah, they have to report. If you're convicted of human trafficking, you have to report.
Period, not just juveniles?
Yeah.
Okay, okay. Those are the two things that popped in my mind, and I appreciate that. Housing is something that I think clearly is needed in this circumstance. So I really appreciate your advocacy and the ability to come down and speak on this issue and provide your expertise to this hearing. So thank you, Ms. O'Grady.
Thank you.
The next speaker is Michelle Hanan, who we've heard many times about referenced so far this evening. So thank you so much for coming down. She's the Director of Professional Community Services of the Salvation Army. So thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Chair Klein. I really appreciate the opportunity to be here and talk mostly with my coalition management hat on, and just to give a little explanation about how things move forward there, how I come to wear multiple hats once I figure out how to advance the, anybody? That way works? There we go. Okay. So just a little bit of history of how things really started to get rolling in terms of mobilizing around trafficking here in Columbus. So there were advocates who were really concerned about this, who knew a lot about trafficking prior to 2007, and they were starting the conversations. We got a big boost in 2007 because we were kind of the beneficiary of the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services National Rescue and Restore campaign. And they were looking across the country and identifying cities where they thought there needed to be a coordinated response. And so Columbus was selected as one of those locations. Which was of great benefit to us. So they came in, met with the city, met with leaders, got everybody excited about doing something about human trafficking. And I'm pointing the wrong way again. There we go. So by mid-2007, there was at least a small group of dedicated people, who many of whom are in this room tonight, who were interested in starting to take action on human trafficking. The Salvation Army was one of many organizations that was at the table at that time, and we happened to host the first meeting and take minutes and thus become kind of ordained as the coalition manager. And so since that time, we've been in a role where we've been able to help to just coordinate and coordinate the coalition and provide a forum for our community to address this issue collectively and collaboratively. Within the coalition, as I'll note in a few places, the Salvation Army is also a provider of services to victims of human trafficking, so we're part of the network and we also help to coordinate its efforts. So we started out our initial meeting with about 13 people came to our first meeting, and it has grown exponentially since that time. We have over 100 organizations now that partner with the coalition, and very importantly, hundreds of individuals. So they may not be representing their business or their place of work, but they are the lifeblood of the coalition and doing a lot of the work, volunteering and making change. Our efforts with the coalition, let me back up here to say that this is not 100 logos, but this is just kind of a sampling of some of the many partners that we have at the table, and really not, I'm to the point where not a whole lot more fits in there. I might need to make things smaller at some point. But you can see that there's a really broad range, including law enforcement, social services, the faith community, the medical community, educators, just a lot of folks who have come together to try to build what we now are considering our continuum of care in the Columbus area. Oops, wrong way again. So our coalition's work is focused in five areas, and one of those areas is really just a liaison to the Central Ohio Human Trafficking Task Force. So it's a partnership with us, and we connect there through those efforts. The other areas, victim services, public awareness, demand reduction, and legislation and advocacy, are committees that function through volunteer elected leaders from the community who help to lead others with like minds in trying to collectively, holistically dealing with this problem. One of the things that we've found here locally, but we also know nationally from others who've gone before us, is that it addressing this issue really takes everyone coming together, that it's not something that any one of these areas each area can make change, but together we can really, hopefully, really move the bar. I'm going to talk a little bit more about victim services in a moment and what our continuum of care looks like, but I wanted to highlight the importance of public awareness and demand reduction, and just to support the comments that others have made here tonight. When we initially organized as a coalition, it was by that time kind of late 2007, we identified 3 victims of trafficking that year for the remainder of that calendar year, and we had very little, our efforts around public awareness were really just beginning at that time. As we've really grown our efforts and grown a whole cadre of volunteers who go out and speak on the issue, who speak at schools, who talk to emergency room personnel, who do webinars and talk to the judicial system, and we're just really blanketing the community, we now identify easily over 150, 200 or so confirmed victims of trafficking each year, and then far greater numbers of folks who are suspected or considered to be at serious risk. But as we've talked about tonight, without efforts around demand reduction and trying to stop this on the front end, what I'm going to share with you in a minute is what I think is a really state-of-the-art continuum of care that we've developed in this community, and it's amazing and it needs to continue to grow. But the very best thing would be that is not needed at all, and that we can actually put an end to this on the front end, and that really has to be done through changing behavior and attitude. And that's where the importance of public awareness comes into play. So let me just jump ahead and share a little bit about our continuum of care. I brought 2 handouts that I think there are extras over here if others are in need of them. The continuum of care is now a 2-page document that really highlights efforts that start with victim identification and then move all the way through long-term restoration. And you'll see from that document that there are a lot of different ways that victims are identified. A really critical part of that work is law enforcement and is CATCH and the empowerment program with juvenile court and the work that is happening in the justice system. Many other victims are identified through community outreach efforts. So that may include training, partnership, for example, with Mount Carmel Health Systems, where they're training all of their personnel to identify. The number of hotline calls we've received just as a result of their efforts has really grown amazingly over the past few months. Street outreach, some of our partners, Star House, Huckleberry House, have been mentioned. Salvation Army, we conduct weekly street outreach to those who are being sold on the streets of Columbus. The SOAP effort, which is the brainchild of Teresa Flores and is really now a national effort to get bars of soap with the hotline into hotels, particularly around our large events. So people come from a lot of different directions and areas. And once that person makes contact with us, which could typically comes, really the funnel is kind of coming through the court system, through the law enforcement task force, or through our hotline effort. And once they make that contact with us, we have partners in our continuum whose job it is to respond anytime 24/7 to the needs of those identified victims. So depending on the age and the type of trafficking, either the Salvation Army or our partner Grace Haven would respond anytime 24/7 to assist that victim or that survivor in getting to safety. And once, again, the person is in a safe situation, there's a really strong focus on helping them move from a state of being a victim to really restoration and thriving in the community. And you can see from the continuum of care that there are so many partners who are really critical to that work. We have been able to fill a lot of gaps, and things have gotten a lot stronger over the years in terms of the work that we're able to do. When you think about even the massage parlor case that was discussed earlier from January, it really underscores the importance of having everyone at the table, everything from those who were cooking and donating food to assist the survivors, to the really amazing partnership with Asian American Community Services, because while we have amazing staff at Salvation Army, not so much with the foreign languages. But beyond interpretation was really critical, but beyond that was the cultural orientation and simply the case management and the partnership that they brought, and it really forged a great working relationship. But we're really unique. It's just unique that we have those partnerships, I think, here in this community. So the comprehensive case management really takes place over, it's really time unlimited. As Judge Herbert said, change takes multiple years, and so there's no end to that involvement. The entire progress, you know, the process is intended to help people become more independent, obviously, and build strong support systems in the community. But because of the really severe trauma associated with this crime, it's not something that is resolved within a 6-month period or a 9-month period. Some of our really important areas of growth in the coalition recently have been around partners who are working on the employment, development, and hiring survivors. And so thinking about examples like Freedom a la Carte, who works closely with survivors from CATCH and also from other avenues in our community, and is doing just amazing work and cooking wonderful food and hiring survivors and allowing that next step. She has a name, Cleaning Services, is another great new example. So we're really encouraged to see growth in that area. We do, though, however, I'm going to flip ahead with a few of these here. We have some gaps that I'd like to, I'll highlight those in a moment. I want to share a little bit of data with you first, and then I want to talk just at the end a little bit about some of the gaps and the challenges that we're experiencing. Part of our job at the coalition is to create a picture of what trafficking looks like in the community, and there are some issues with that, this being a really hidden crime, and others have discussed some of the challenges around data. Some good things are happening, though. We do now, we're participating in an initiative that is happening statewide, where coalitions within the state are collecting data on a quarterly basis, and we're starting to now be able to have a little bit better picture. I've also included in the handouts our first quarter of data that we were piloting for a few quarters. We got to the place now where we were able to release an actual update on those who were identified, but just to highlight a few of those. I'm going to come backward there for a moment. So this is just a quarter of data. It's looking from April through June. We received 99 hotline calls here from the Central Ohio area. 59 of them were from victims who were looking for services immediately. So, and the others were, the vast other majorities were really were callers who were reporting tips. In that time period, we identified 58 persons who were confirmed to be victims of trafficking, and we also identified or interacted with others who have a very strong likelihood. So of that other 233, a large number of those are individuals we met in street outreach, and given the fact that they are selling sex on the streets of Columbus and understanding the nature of trafficking and the overlap with prostitution, there's a strong likelihood that those folks are also would also meet the state definition. This might be a little bit difficult to see. I think it is even for me. But the majority of those we identified were identified in sex trafficking. We're working really hard to identify more labor trafficking cases, and we're making some strides there. The majority of those identified were adults, but you can see there's quite a scope of age range there. The majority, again, were female, and majority were American, but 14%, which is not an insignificant percent of folks who were identified who were actually from other countries. Let me back up to, I wanted to share data from the Salvation Army because it is a little bit more longitudinal since it's our program. So we haven't had combined coalition data at the same level until recently, and as we've been working through this pilot, this just gives you an idea of just our part of the continuum of care. And since we began the work really in July of 2008. And so you'll see, again, the first year was 3, so numbers have increased significantly over the years. And you, again, mostly the majority of those are female Americans who are trafficked in the sex industry, but those percentages are changing as we're getting better at partnering and identifying. And there's a really pretty wide diversity of countries of origin for those who are coming from other locations. Street outreach, we have been conducting that weekly since 2010, and so we have had You can see almost 1,600 separate interactions with individuals on the streets. And let me just move a bit here to the gaps. So as has been, others have mentioned, and just to underscore, we have a very serious need for immediate, safe, trauma-informed shelter. So from the moment someone's identified, there's a need for shelter at that moment that will compound and become a need for housing. So that whole housing continuum from shelter through long-term care is very lacking and is really critical. We're so grateful, and it's so amazing that Grace Haven has opened their doors, and now we have this amazing resource that is really very scarce across the country, and we're lucky to have it here in Central Ohio. They have capacity for 8, and as of last week, I know they had 4, I think, girls who were in residence, and I suspect by now that that's much higher. So we're going to go move through those spaces very quickly. For many of the survivors, whether they are identified as minors or as adults, there really is a need for medically supervised opiate detox, and we're really, again, fortunate in a partnership with Mary Haven, and they are doing amazing work in getting our folks in, even though they are very overburdened. But they can only open their doors so much because they actually have limits as well. But they're an amazing partner, but need to be greater. They need greater resources to increase their capacity. I really do want to underscore again the importance of public awareness, and it's noted, I think I was just flipping through the federal strategic plan on human trafficking, and public awareness takes a big center stage there as well, because we understand with such a hidden crime that you can only find it if people know how to look for it and identify it. And we really, part of our coalition effort, we've trained, I think, around 28,000 individuals over the past few years, reaching a lot of people, and we're reaching them one-on-one, but the power of a public awareness campaign to allow us to reach a far greater number of people, that's kind of immeasurable, you know.
Do you have any more information on that? Are you planning on talking any more on the public awareness side of, like, what ideally would that look like coming from the city?
Right. There are a couple of different approaches that could be taken. An immediate approach that is our current recommendation would be to use the public awareness campaign materials that were developed by the Governor's Task Force on Human Trafficking. They were developed to be customizable for any community. So all the artwork, all the language has already been created through focus groups with the women from CATCH and others. And so those materials are out there. What we would like to do is to be able to blanket the city with those through a variety of media, so through certainly billboards and bench signs and some of those traditional avenues, also looking at public service announcements, just the use of social media. And you know, in our ideal world, we think a campaign would be about a 3-month kind of saturation, and it would continue, of course, in many ways after, but we would want to focus our efforts around that in a 3-month period.
Is there a human trafficking awareness week or month or?
January.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yes. So that was part of the thought as well. It would be a nice launch at that time, and then be able to continue the momentum through the spring to raise awareness. So that campaign would hopefully help people understand that it's a diverse crime, it's a hidden crime, and also, you know, that essentially how to identify it and how to report it, and trying to drive people to the national hotline, the National Human Trafficking Hotline, as a place that it partners with all of us here and making connections.
All right, thank you. I appreciate your comments. I asked my questions on the fly, so I don't think I have any other questions. But one popped in my head for Judge Herbert. Out of the 1,500 women that come through the court, how many of them are repeat offenders versus how many of them are like the first time there?
I don't know. Sorry.
Does CPD have any information on that? No?
Rule of thumb. Chairman Klein, I think a rule of thumb, I would put 15% to 20% are repeat offenders today. That number was, though, much higher years ago. I think we're seeing an influx of newly addicted and now newly victimized human trafficking victims. So I think the percentage is dropping just because the volume is increasing.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. All right, next is Kathy Chen. Thank you, Kathy, for coming down. She's the Executive Director of the Asian American Community Services.
Well, thank you, Chair Klein. I really appreciate to have the opportunity to be able to speak here today on behalf of the Asian communities. I really appreciate all of the efforts that everyone has made here today. Director Speaks talked about, human trafficking is modern day slavery. I remember that terminology of slavery was back in my history days, and I remember those photos in black and white, and you have those image that, you know, it's long, long, long time ago. Is, you know, I would never imagine in my lifetime I will actually witness slavery in the 21st century. So this actually, when the call came in from Michelle's office with just a simple request saying we need some interpreting services. And in fact, at that time, they couldn't even tell us what language they need. They all can say was Chinese, we think. Which dialogue? Don't know yet. Hopefully we can identify pretty soon for you. So I say, okay, what's the possibility that they need this or that? Well, can you find someone who can speak Mandarin and Cantonese at the same time? So in case, we have to go either way. So here I am trying to go through the list of the interpreters and my agency and say, okay, who can we do and what can we do? And there were a large number of demand, you know, because there were actually 18 women were identified at that. Well, when we went in, it was really purely just thinking, okay, we're providing interpreting services, which all we're there for is just a tape recorder. We're there to provide a voice that they don't have. Well, as soon as we got in, realized, but let me take it back a little further. Michelle's staff was very, very generous. Right before the whole operation, she sat down with all of us and even the law enforcement and say, can you quickly provide us 15 minutes of cultural competency training? We need to know what type of food, what type of clothing, what medical assistance they might need, and what protocols do we need? So, you know, right away we did a really quick crash course and provide that, just a quick glimpse, but not knowing what we're walking into. The minute when the law enforcement brought them in, we realized that was not what we're there for. We're there for more than just a tape recorder. We're there for more than just a voice. We're there to provide the gap. And what are the gap? You know, by working with the woman, we realized when they came here, they came for American dream. Like every single one of us who came to this country, we're trying to pursue the American dream. That, you know, the Rockefeller, you know, white fence house, that's what we all imagine one day that we're going to have here in United States. You know, official at the Office of Criminal Justice Office asked me, what do they do to control all this woman? Why can't they run away? Why can't they seek out for help? Unlike most of the human trafficking incidents, they don't control them by substance abuse. They don't control them by other form. They control them by feeding them greed. When they are in their country, making only $100 a month to feed the whole family, when they came here, they are able to enjoy all the brand name, iPad, iPhone, all the luxury that never can ever sing in their life, and then every month making $5,000-$6,000, that's the control. They don't use any chemicals. They don't use any drug. They don't use any weapons. That's what they use. They know that they have no way to communicate with the outsider because the only language they have is just whatever that they are speaking. And they control them by the fear of the fact, you know, we are a family. In Asian culture, we don't betray the family. So when the victims call those controller, big brother and big sister, they're just not a simple terminology. That actually represents the power, the authority, the fear. And that's how they control them. So when they call them my big sister, they're giving them all their respect. They're giving them all their faith. And even in this case, I mean, their freedom. Now, when we work with the victims, another thing that we're trying to work with them is let them understand the concept of what we call human trafficking. It's easy to find translation, find interpretation, but there's actually no really form for them to understand saying, what have my trafficker had done to me? Now I've become a commodity. When that word came out, it was so powerful. And how can we try to explain that to into the culturally appropriate terminology to them and help them to understand? And so that was the first concept. We have to try to help them to understand they are victim. We have to try to help them to understand they had commit a, their perpetrator has committed a crime. We need you to help us to solve that and help them to understand what kind of crime it is. So there was lots of concepts involved in here that, you know, was just more than interpreting services. But most importantly, what I witnessed is just not this, you know, ugly side of a humankind. What I witnessed was all the law enforcement and all the agency and, you know, Judge Herbert, with all your kindness, created that, you know, special program. You don't treat them like a suspect. You don't treat them like a criminal. What instead you offer said, what can we do for you? I mean, the law enforcement said, we will help you to apply T visa, U visa. We will help you to provide the legal services that you need to get to be able to legally stay in United States. So one day they can complete their American dream. And so that, you know, is with that effort that, you know, I kind of volunteer my whole organization and my whole staff and say, we're doing this. And, what I have learned from this is the lack of knowledge. And like Michelle saying, public awareness. You know, what are we talking about? You know, when you open, and I learned later on through the process, some of those massage parlors did not even apply for license when they opened the door. How can they operate? Why make them come to Ohio? Well, because we were told Ohio do not need legal status. You can come here as an illegal alien and still be able to work here, and you know, no one check your, you know, document. You don't need a driver's license. You don't need a social security. You don't need on and on. No, those are not the truth. They're, you know. So as a community organization, we are partnered with many Asian communities. What we're trying to do is we're going to go out for public services, try to bring the awareness. We are talking to small business to let them understand, besides, you know, sex trade, human trafficking, there's also labor trafficking here. What are we talking about when the Ohio labor law, what, you know, what are constitutes in that? And that's, we're actually put together a form to invite all the small business from Central Ohio to join that so they can understand what the labor law is involved, and as well as, you know, massage parlors, what the regulations are also required for. We also are working with an expert who has traveled many, many years and dedicated many of her years in China, Africa, which is some of the area that Michelle has shown. Where, you know, how they become victims. They're actually coming to, she's actually coming to Ohio at the end of this month to do some training and to talk to the community. But, you know, most importantly, that I think that the reason I'm here today, I want to say all my thanks on behalf of all the 18 victims or the survivor to do something that they didn't get to do to all of you who worked so hard for them, is to give them thanks. In Asian culture, we don't shake hands. So what we do, I thank everyone who was involved, and I thank everyone who continued to work on this task, and I thank everyone who are listening out and willing to work with all the Asian community. We are here to continue to fight, and we will always be here to fight. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Chen, and certainly thank you for the advocacy that you do in our community. Director Speaks, we license massage parlors in the city of Columbus, correct?
In the city of Columbus, we do. However, many of our surrounding communities do not.
Do we have any restrictions in the licensing scheme where licenses could be revoked if evidence of human trafficking is found?
Absolutely, and we work in that aspect, absolutely.
So a massage parlor's license could be revoked if evidence of human trafficking is found?
I believe that we should look at our
There's opportunity. You think there's opportunity in the code for us to, because massage parlors, if they're, because they're licensed, they could be subject to random inspections to make sure for health reasons. So that could be an area that the city could expand the licensing scheme, our regulatory scheme, to allow that if evidence of human trafficking or prostitution is found at a massage parlor, then we would be able to revoke the license. That's something that we could explore as a city.
Absolutely. Right now, in order to get a license, we look at a criminal background check. But in terms of ongoing criminal action at that location, we should look and review our city ordinance.
Okay.
And we'd love to work with you on that.
Sure. Thank you. Yes, of course. We're partners, Director. And our final speaker is a victim's advocate, Vanessa Perkins. Thank you for your patience in sitting here, Vanessa. But the floor is yours, Ms. Perkins.
Thank you for this opportunity. My heart has been beating out of my chest because you put me at the last.
I can, let me talk some more to give you, you know, check, a chance to unwind a little bit.
Yeah, right. So I'm just going to share a little bit about my experience, kind of how I ended up in human trafficking, how I became an advocate of victims in this area. This arena here is amazing me today. I am so humbled to be sitting here. When I first got to Catch Court, I had never heard of human trafficking. Anybody I ever talked to hadn't heard of human trafficking. It was a very, very foreign term to me. So to be sitting here today is very surreal, and I think it is amazing that I am in a house full of amazing people, and it is really, really an honor. So just a background on me, I grew up in Nelsonville, little five-second town, you know, southeast Ohio, down by Athens. I grew up in a somewhat dysfunctional family, and I was sexually assaulted from the age of 4 to 12 by the guy that was, I thought he was my father, and he was supposed to protect me and teach me about love and boundaries. And because he had betrayed me and violated me and assaulted me for so many years, even once is too many, of course, my perception of what love is and what approval is and boundaries are and what's okay and what's not okay, all that was distorted. And so very young, I started drinking and smoking weed, and that just took away that feeling of disgust, of self-hate, of loathing. So I drank a lot because that made me okay with me. So I think that's part of how I... The boundaries of what's okay. What I didn't know, what I learned later on, is these traffickers know exactly what they're doing. They know exactly what to look for. They prey on vulnerabilities, and any of us can have them, not even just people with sexual assault history of any sort, just vulnerabilities. They know what they're doing, and that's what they prey on. So I didn't know this was happening. Again, I grew up in a very dysfunctional, aggressive home, so a lot of the things that was happening to me was very normal, was rational, is what made sense to me, and I brought it on myself. I was convinced that I brought it on myself. I put myself in this situation. I stayed, and plus, no one else is going to want me. I mean, so this goes on for years, and so I didn't just stop at drinking. I started, I was smoking weed, and it went on. I got on pain pills from a back injury, and then just stayed on them, all this stuff just to numb out who I was, to numb out the thoughts and the feelings that I had, which was just piling on the self-disgust from day after day that I couldn't be a productive member of society or even just a thoughtful human being. And all the abuse that I endured, I was pretty aggressive myself. I didn't know how not to be. Some of it was survival. I remember going into this abusive relationship, and in the beginning of the relationship, I would like hold my ground. I would stand there, but by the end of that relationship, I was head down, no words. I was on a regular basis hiding from my family because I had a black eye, or I was just sick of them coming and saving me and me just going back to them, and they were very sick of it too. The police officers, they were sick of it as well. So I moved to Columbus, truthfully, because dope was easier here. And it was cheaper, so that's why I moved to Columbus. And so when I got here, I came here, I was very isolated. I'd already done a lot of bad things. A lot of bad things have been done to me. And this guy comes up to me, and I'll never forget this. He was a very good-looking guy. He had perfect, beautiful smile. He was very kind to me. And I'm lost and alone and broken in the middle of the bottoms from Nelsonville, trying to act like I know what I'm doing. And he he kind of took me under his wing. He told me all the right things. And telling you guys this, I have a sense of shame and embarrassment behind it because it makes me, I get the message of, you stupid girl. You stupid girl. That's what I tell myself. And I've been working on this for years, which is why I think I can share it with you. So he was just kind, and he would say, man, you are beautiful. You are amazing. He would just tell me all these things, and he'd put his arms around me, and he'd protect me. I gave him money to buy me dope, and he brought the dope back. And so building and earning that trust. I hadn't felt that good in a long time. And so that went on for a little while, and then this guy who very quickly I became to believe that I loved him. I actually believe that I loved him. And I still today think that I did love him to the best that I could love anybody at that time. And I believe that he loved me. And I'm still confused on whether he really did or not today. And I know that's crazy. It seems twisted, but that's the truth from me. And so he looked me straight in my eye, and his eyes went from the light to the dark, and he became mean, and he became aggressive, and he made me do things that I never thought was possible. I believed that I was doing it, I was choosing it. And just like other people had shared, like I could relate to everything people were saying. It is very real. Like I didn't know that I wasn't making the choices on my own. I didn't realize that I was being coerced and driven by fear even, because I'm tough, I'm surviving. And I have to do what I gotta do to survive. And plus, I mean, what am I gonna do? Like, I can't go to the police officers, they're gonna arrest me because I've done things that are illegal that will actually put handcuffs on me. And I've never seen anybody that was doing this do anything different with their life anyway, whether it was drugs or the prostitution piece. I've never seen anybody change from that to becoming anything better. I had no clue. So that went on for a long time. And I'll tell you a little bit about how this man controlled me. I didn't know this was going on at the time, but I can look back and see it. And it's very disturbing to me. It infuriates me. A lot of it was through physical abuse. Like I work in a domestic violence unit, and I read domestic violent files all the time. And the thing that hits me the most, it isn't when someone gets hit in the face with a fist, it's when someone gets hit in the face with an open hand. And that's because that's what my trafficker did to me all the time. And he wouldn't do it right then. He wouldn't say, go get this, and if I didn't bring back the money, if I wasn't back quick enough, that was a big one for him. I was out too long, he thinks I was out spending the money instead of giving it to him. Or that I was hiding money. He, on a regular basis, stripped me completely naked in the middle of the street in the Bottoms right there on town, completely naked to search me for money that he thought I was hiding. I was terrified. I wasn't hiding anything from him. That's even relevant at this point. But he would say the words, I'm going to dog you, bitch, excuse my language. And when he said those words, I knew that it was coming, but he wouldn't do it right then. He let me live in torture, in fear. I knew he would walk behind me with his head over my shoulder and walk me up the stairs and cut up all my clothes and this form of intimidation and control. And I believe this is my fault. I did this. I made him so angry. He loves me so much. That's why he's getting so angry. And just the distorted thinking that I know does not make sense, but is real. It really is. And it kept me going for years of just doing what he said. For one, I'm scared because he's unpredictable. I have no idea what he's going to do. On top of that, I'm no good. What am I going to do from here? I've already burned all my bridges anyway down home. I can't tell them what's going on with me because I'm the stupid one. I'm the idiot. I did this. All the shame that comes with that is hard. It is so hard to recover from that kind of a life. It is definitely not a six-month or a nine-month process. It took me, I don't even remember the first 6 months of my recovery. I don't. I have people tell me certain things like I was mean, and I probably was, in fear for my life, trying to do something different, having no clue where to go, knowing that I just don't want to go back that way, and that's all I knew. And so this went on for years, and this trafficker, he would send me out and then follow me, and I didn't know he was following me, and I tried to get in this car, and he'd come up behind me, he'd snatch me out from behind, out of this car, and drag me down an alley. I remember I was in flip-flops, and he was dragging me backwards, caveman style, literally, and he dragged me into a house, and he kept me there for hours with this woman who had a gun on the table, and he picks up a hammer, and he hits me in my leg with a hammer. I don't know if I had a real cracked rib or not, but it definitely felt like it, and just lit my face up left and right, would tell me to cover my head, he's about to tear me up, like all these forms of intimidation and control, and the stuff that is just, I knew I was going to die that night. I didn't want to live. anyway. I couldn't live like that. So, I mean, I knew I was going to die that night, and he told me we was going to walk out, and we were going to go separate ways, and I was relieved, like, thank God. And then we walk out, and he picks me up, and he carries me, because at this point, I can hardly even walk. I can't breathe, and I couldn't breathe for months. It was awful, and couldn't go to the hospital. So I would go, he picked me up, and he actually took me to a dope house and told them that a John did this to me, and to give me some dope so I could go back out on the block. And they were like, no, we know that you did it, but we're going to give her dope anyway. They gave me dope, and he took it from me. And I went back out on the block anyway. I was very stuck, and I was very controlled, and I was scared to death. And I had no idea what to do. I had no idea. I seen no light in the tunnel. I preferred death over that life. I didn't have the courage to kill myself, but I definitely didn't want to be alive anymore, that's for sure. And so I got arrested several times. I have several solicitings, drug charges. And this last time, Catch Court found me. And this was back in 2009 when it was just starting to float. And I don't know how they found me. I honestly don't remember saying yes. I think I told you that before. I don't remember saying yes to the program because it was so foggy, not only from the dope, but, man, the trauma, the head trauma. I had an inside knot, concave spot on my head, and I couldn't remember anything for 6 months. Like, I couldn't hold a conversation. I couldn't keep my head up. I couldn't look you in the eye, like, all this stuff. I have no doubt if I was put on the stand, and I seen a jury trial of domestic violence yesterday and today, and this is what making me think of it. If I was put on the stand, there's no way I'd have been a good witness. There's no way that a jury would have believed what I was saying, because I couldn't remember anything. It was the sun went up, the sun went down, the sun went up, the sun went down. That was my life. And so anyway, Catch Court comes to my rescue somehow, and I owe my life to Catch Court. I owe my life to Catch Court. So I had cases in another county. Judge Herbert called the other county to try to convince them to let me stay up here. How in the world he did that is beyond me, because Athens is not the easiest county to talk to, in my personal opinion. I don't have the greatest of experiences down there. So, but he did, and it did work. And so I started this program. I get put into this room, and I know you remember this, Judge, because you talk about it. I come in there, and I come in with my head down, no light in my eyes, no smile on my face. I can't hold a conversation. My words are yes, no, I'm fine. Yes, no, I'm fine. That's all I could do. And I was scared to death. I didn't trust the judge. He's a judge. I'm not going to trust him. And I'm not going to trust police officers. They have arrested me how many times? And at that point in time, they wasn't saying to me, like, this isn't the life for you, or there's a solution. I don't even know if they knew at that time. I don't know. But I wasn't receiving that, and if I was, I missed it, which is possible, too, because there was a lot of stuff going on in my head. So I get put into this amazing place of women who understand why, still today, almost 6 years later, I think about my trafficker and wonder how he's doing. Wonder if maybe he's changed, or if he's still doing this, still living that life, or he's even still alive. I still think about that. Makes me feel, again, like that stupid girl when I tell you guys that. But that's what happens, I think, and I think a lot of survivors go through this, and I think it's important for us to talk about, because it's true, it's real, and if I leave it in my head, it might make sense one day to go find out, and I'm scared to death of that. So I'm telling you guys. So this, they said, two-year program, which, honestly, I was so broken, and I was so done at that point. I didn't care what they said. I was doing it. That's just where I was at in my life. I was in jail for like 4.5 months before I actually walked into the courtroom unhandcuffed. and then they kept looking me in my eye and kept encouraging me to talk and asking me what I need. Like, made me feel like a human being again. Made me feel like I am worth it, because I promise you, I did not walk in there thinking I deserved to get better. I didn't walk in there thinking I deserved a good life. I still don't know how I have the life that I have. I don't know. And I'm so thankful for it. I owe it to Catch Court and to Amethyst. Catch Court made me go to Amethyst, and I wouldn't have went if they didn't make me. That's probably the truth. I don't know. But there I got, and there with Catch Court, a lot of trauma counseling. I didn't even know the problems that I had. I had no idea that these problems even existed. And when we would talk about it, and I'd be free of certain problems, and this is a lot of hard, dark work. I understand why people get high again. I understand, because it's hard. And it's scary, and it doesn't make sense, and I feel like it's never going to end. I'm going to feel like this forever. It is hard. And so with the support and love that comes in those communities, I feel like the luckiest person on the planet, because I got dropped into these communities. I didn't ask for them. I didn't even know they exist. I'm from Nelsonville. So I get dropped in the most unique, amazing places that I think exist, and powerful people that want to help one another. So I start this journey, and at this point in time, I don't have my son anymore. By all means, I shouldn't have, because I was in a lot of bad places with a lot of bad people, and I think he was being protected by a power greater than myself. And it took me 2 years to get my son back, and a year and a half of that, I didn't think he should be with me because of the shame and the guilt that I carried. I can't believe I'm the person I am. My little baby, he don't deserve to be with someone like me. And I believed that for a year and a half and still went to court for him, not because I wanted to, but because the people around me were like, that is your baby. And you deserve him, and he deserves you, trying to convince me and help me to get rid of the shame and this guilt, which is heavy. We belong together, so about a year and a half in, finally I was like, oh my gosh, that is my baby. He does belong with me. I just may be okay enough for that child, and now we've been united ever since. He's gonna be 8. I got sober and started this recovery journey when he was 3, close to 3, not even 3, I think it was 2. And we live together, I have full custody of him, and I don't believe that he should be anywhere else. He belongs with me, and I know that today. It took a long time for me to get there, and a lot of parenting classes. I had no idea how to parent. So this comes with a slew of issues. Like, it's not just drug addiction, it's not just trauma, it's so much guilt and grief. All the stuff that comes with it is we need places, facilities, and Amethyst and Catch Credit saved my life. And I love that we're talking about houses, and I also love that employment came up. I think those are two very, very important. Again, I don't know how I have the life I have. Like, how do I work at the courthouse that had put handcuffs on me? I don't know how that happens, but I know because of that, because the perception is changing from criminalizing these people to their victims, let's help them. I have been given that help, and then they could see me as a human being again and employed me. And I didn't start out there. Like, I went to Freedom a la Carte, which taught me how to be an employee again, because I couldn't. I had no idea how to show up on time, to dress right, to talk right. I didn't know how to do that stuff, and they helped teach me that. Without Freedom a la Carte, without Doma International is what it was then, I would have not landed the job at the city attorney's office. And things happen in my life thanks to you guys who want to look at this differently. So I cannot express my gratitude enough. I cannot thank you enough. No way. And it's not just my life. It's my son's. It's my mom's. It's my brother's. They didn't know where I was for years. They didn't even know where my son was. He was with me, but they didn't know where we were for a long time. And all the people that I hurt, you know? So thanks to this recovery process, thanks for the hope and the chance that you gave Judge Herbert. And I didn't even know that connection. I don't know all this stuff. I didn't even know what you did when I came here last time. I just came because I trust the people that asked me to come. And so I did a little research, and I'm hearing great things about you. And from people that I trust. Now, this is a big deal. So I am grateful for you guys. Thank you.
Thank you for those kind words. And more importantly, thank you for sharing the story. Because you've been there, I'm curious of your perspective and opinion. And I know you can't speak on behalf of every single victim. But what do we do with the women that you once were, that wasn't ready for Catch, you know, addicted to drugs, in and out of jail? What do you think we need to do?
Yeah, this is tough, because I just have a little mind and a little experience, and mostly just my own experience. I do know that getting the information to them, like, I love this Catch 101, and it was called Catch Light. I think you asked that last time we talked. It was called Catch Light, but now it's Catch 101. I think that can be really helpful. And for me, I needed to be separated from that life. So for me, I needed to go to jail. If there was a better opportunity, or a better, an alternate solution, instead of re-victimizing and re-traumatizing somebody by throwing them in jail, then I wouldn't, like, this house, this room today, I bet could come up with something to separate them. Like, the only thing in my mind can be like a lockdown detox that's not victimizing, but is like, what kind of food do you like? We talked a little bit, I was talking to Annie earlier today. In another area, they, first question isn't, what was your drug of choice, or where are you going, or anything like that. It was just, what do you want to eat? Like, and just kind of making them a human being again, and giving them choices, and the patience and the love and the consistency. And again, I don't have a great answer for that, but just, yeah.
Well, we spend $5.4 million a year on incarceration. So maybe we could divert the $5.4 million into some sort of detox program that helps people help themselves, if that's a possibility. Because $5.4 million is a lot of money.
True.
That I'd hate to be spending in jail if we have an opportunity to spend it to help people. Thank you again.
You're welcome.
I really appreciate it. And certainly thank you, Director Speaks, Commander Cameron, Sergeant Chrysler, and certainly the Honorable Paul Herbert, Counselor Murray, Counselor O'Grady, Section Chief over at Mike DeWine's office, Sean Ahn over at Red Cross, Ms. Chen, thank you, and of course, Ms. Perkins, thank you. I thought this was a wonderful hearing. We have some speakers, and then I'm going to offer just a couple random final thoughts, because I have a feeling we'll be having another hearing just because we opened up a can of worms on so many different subjects on addiction. I'm curious to know more about addiction, which again, in the concentric circles and overlaps, you know, this is a broader conversation about addiction in our community generally, not just how it relates to human traffic victims of prostitution, but just I think heroin itself is a significant problem in our community. And then, of course, what treatment options are available, how much those cost. I think that's probably a good theme for our next hearing as we dive into this further. So I have speakers slips, maybe seven or eight of them. Again, if you want to speak and you haven't signed up yet, there's speaker slips right there. They're blue. You can put them in the – actually, don't even put them in the box. Wave them and give them to Gretchen, Gretchen and Gina, who work with me. And everyone who wants to speak will have a chance. The first one's David Cunningham. Shared Hope International, whom, come on up, David. You come on up, generally give 3 minutes to speak. We've talked before, Mr. Cunningham, appreciate you coming down to City Hall. If you just could identify the group that you're with, I'd appreciate it. Floor is yours.
This mic is on? Okay. I am a volunteer for Shared Hope International, which was formed by Linda Smith in 1998, who was a congressman for the state of Washington. We work throughout the country on human trafficking. Among other things, we offer awareness materials such as Chosen, a video that shows domestic minor sex trafficking is happening in all socioeconomic levels of neighborhoods throughout the country. It really mirrors Vanessa Perkins' story, and without somebody, even somebody being vulnerable, who is under much less duress than she was. In Columbus, there are about 20 Shared Hope International volunteers like me. You've heard from Michelle Hannon. We recognize the Central Ohio Rescue and Restore Coalition as being an organization that is very well structured to handle victims from victims, and we work very closely with them. Rescue and Rescore is developing. We need more public awareness. I think you've talked about it several times. Commander Cameron said the problem begins with buyers of sex. It's okay in our community because there's no public outcry. What we are recommending, and I believe we've submitted a recommendation to you about a public awareness campaign, and Michelle referred to it briefly, as a billboards and PSAs and bench signs and a number of things like things of that nature. What I'd like to mention is that, you know, a couple of hundred years ago, slavery was okay. What we would like to do is make sure that the public awareness, the value system that has been that has changed because in modern times, takes hold in with domestic minor sex trafficking, human trafficking of all kinds. If there wasn't a human outcry for stopping it, it will continue. If there is a human outcry to stop it, it will stop. Part of the organization I'm part of is Defenders, and the main part of that, part of Shared Hope International, is to work on stopping the buying of sex, getting men aware of this is an abuse of people. This is not just somebody that's a working girl that they're dealing with. That concludes my recommendation. I'd very strongly recommend that a public awareness campaign such as Michelle's recommended be implemented.
Thank you, Mr. Cunningham, and I've seen the video, and they are powerful, and would encourage everyone to check it out, and maybe we can find a way to put that on the City Council website, or at least on my personal social media page. If there's a way to do that, certainly welcome it, because I think it speaks a powerful message of how important this issue is, so thank you. The next speaker is Greg Pace. Mr. Pace, and while he's on his way up, I think I said Red Cross, which clearly you're not. And so, Greg Cross, I just gave blood, it's phenomenal. But the Salvation Army, thank you for the Salvation Army. Yeah. Mr. Pace.
Hello, Councilperson Klein. Thank you for letting me come up here. My name's Greg Pace. I'm, as Dave Cunningham is, I'm with Shared Hope. I'm a volunteer. And I participated in several presentations on DMST, domestic minor sex trafficking, in the Central Ohio area. And I would say that what I've come out of this is I've sensed some sorts of resistance to opening up of this conversation in terms of trying to get presentations in schools and so forth. And it's kind of interesting, but one presentation that we did at a church, a big, large church here in town, and it was over a year ago, and the first presentation, almost no men showed up. It was almost all women that came to this presentation, and then the church actually supported and did another presentation a few months after that, and then all the husbands and fathers showed up with the women after that. So it was kind of an interesting dynamic. Another example is one of our people that we work with in Shared Hope in their local area has been working with the police department of Dublin, Ohio. And her first impression was that, we don't have that problem here in Dublin. Dublin's a rich community. We don't have sex trafficking problem. And after a while, she started to understand how this is Every community is a breeding ground, can be a breeding ground for sex trafficking, as they found out. Now they're actually getting into the school system. They're actually talking to the superintendent, but it took a long time to get this process going. My personal project I've been working on over the last 3 or 4 months is trying to get into a school in the Linden area, high school in the Linden area, and I visited twice. Brought them information, tried to get the chosen video to them and so forth. And almost every week for the last couple of months, I've given voicemails to the principal of the school and I haven't heard anything back. And so this is just kind of giving you an idea. It's when we're trying to reach forth into the public about this issue, it's a very touchy issue, that there's some drag in trying to get it to the public. And even I think in the mayor's office, it's my understanding that it's more of an economic aspect of some drag in terms of having any kind of a campaign where it might affect bringing people into the town, that type of a thing. So I think there's many reasons for resistance to bringing this subject into the air, but I'm just hoping that the City Council can really help to support this issue and so that we can get it into a more of a public stature so that people aren't so afraid to get it into the school. Shared Hope really thinks that 12 to 14 years old is the average age that
especially young girls, are brought into the trafficking industry, and they feel that's about the time when the awareness should be in the schools for these children at that age. So thank you very much.
Have you been to any school board meetings to talk to, because I know you've been an advocate on many issues, you've been in front of council on several different issues. Have you been to any school board meetings to talk to the school board members about your approach to schools?
Oh. I haven't gotten that deeply into my advocacy.
Oh, okay.
But
okay.
I'm trying to get this one school, I'm just trying to get school by school, and this is one school I've been trying to get to the principal, and it's very difficult. Yeah. I think with schools in general, that tends to be a difficult thing to get in, to get awareness on this subject. I think it's a pretty touchy subject, probably for a lot of reasons.
Well, thank you for coming down, Ms. Grace. Sister Buchanan? Welcome to City Council Chambers, Sister.
I'd like to thank you, Councilman Klein, for all your support and interest of the problem of human trafficking. I'd like to advocate for more funds and resources for the county, especially for law enforcement, because I know that they are overwhelmed with the amount of cases and calls that come in, and they have such a limited number of staff of vice detectives that can really take care of the problem. So that's my main reason for being here. Now, I know if there are a lot of rescues, then you have to worry about housing. But it's a good worry if we can get these women off the street and give them a life that they deserve, that they don't have to live in fear anymore, and that they have human dignity. And my other thought is how aggressively, because of the lack of personnel on in law enforcement who can do this, how aggressively are they able to go after the pimps and the johns, because of course that will end the demand, and it would be wonderful in our lifetime to be able to see this problem gone away. Thank you.
Thank you, Sister Buchanan. I appreciate you sharing that. Kelly Hughes, is Kelly here, Ms. Hughes? Welcome to Council Chambers.
I just have some questions. This is my first time here. Is
sure.
that appropriate?
Yeah.
Okay.
Try to work with you here.
All right. I live in Clintonville. I've been involved in the human trafficking movement for a few years now. And last year we lost a 15-year-old girl, Sarah Curtis, to what we believe is human trafficking. And I just wonder how, I have not seen anything or heard anything recently about that. And how do we get information about that, I guess?
Why don't you lay out, just to be respectful of your time, lay out all your questions,
okay.
and then we can try to pinpoint them.
Okay.
I'll
and the
take
second
some notes
question
here.
Is, as a community, what can we do about massage parlors opening up in our neighborhoods? There was one recently in Clintonville that opened up, and there has been one at the northwest corner of Sinclair and Lincoln for some time now.
Those two questions?
Mm-hmm.
On the missing persons, I can maybe direct you to the sergeant, commander, or director speaks to follow up with you. They're behind you over your left
okay,
shoulder.
Great.
And then as far as massage parlors, you know, we touched upon it briefly. We're prohibited in the sense of saying you can't locate something there if the zoning is correct and the zoning's proper. But I think what we can do is what the exchange that Director Speaks and I had is we regulate massage parlors, and they are required to have a license to operate in the city of Columbus. And with along with the license, obviously, there's like health and sanitary issues. But can we add a component to that licensing scheme that allows our inspectors, whether it's police or other, any sort of other licensing inspection, to look for evidence of human trafficking? I know when some of the previous discussions leading up this hearing with the folks from the Public Safety Department, you know, evidence of condoms being found, evidence of sexual activity such as that, would then allow us to revoke the permit so they cannot operate anymore legally in the city of Columbus. And that is something that if we go down that path, and it seems to make off the top of my head, and I hate to make commitments without fully vetting them, seems to make sense a little bit. maybe we can partner with our suburban friends to ensure that it's a more comprehensive approach, because I'm not familiar with some of our suburban friends' laws and regulations, but some of them may not even have massage parlor regulations, and maybe encouraging them to enact them. And if they do already have them, encouraging them to add a human trafficking component, so that we're really tackling it not just within the limits, the city limits of the city of Columbus, but really the Central Ohio region.
Perfect. Mm-hmm. Great. Thank you.
Thank you. Tabitha Woodruff. Hello.
Hi.
I'm all right. How you doing? It says here you're with Central Ohio Rescue and Restore Coalition.
I am. I've served as the legislative advocacy chair for the Central Ohio Rescue and Restore Coalition, volunteering with Michelle and a lot of the people in the room here for about 6 years. I'm actually an attorney here in Columbus. I practice elder law and special needs law, but this is sort of my heart and soul, the work that I've been doing with this great group of people and the coalition. Wanted to fill in some gaps. That's kind of why I'm here. So one thing I want to point out is there's not a lot of information out there on labor trafficking. Part of that is because we are working to do a better job to identify labor trafficking victims. So far, through the Salvation Army and other partners, we've identified mostly immigrants that are being forced to work in Columbus in restaurants, in construction, on farms. A lot of times they come across as a wage dispute, where they're working for a while, but their boss refuses to pay them. So in terms of addressing that, I think our solutions are to connect better with the immigrant community, make sure they know services are available, make sure they know it's okay to call law enforcement when they need help, and that we can help them, whether it's a labor abuse or a wage dispute or a rising level of labor trafficking, that it's something we can do to help. So I'd like to see a lot more labor trafficking survivors served personally. Also in terms of massage parlors, it's been brought up a few times. I worked with a group out in Warren, Ohio, who had around a dozen massage parlors in their small Northeast Ohio town, and so they went after it through city council. So the Ohio Revised Code regulates only really kind of medical types of massage therapy. Other types of massage therapy are left up to municipalities to regulate. So one thing they did are very simple new regulations on recreational massage, like not being open between midnight and 6 a.m., little things like that. And actually when they tried to implement those just citywide regulations, they got a lot of pushback from those massage parlors, who were then later raided by BCI and the AG's office. Hmm. But there's definitely a pushback there, and so maybe there's something there Columbus City Council can do in terms of, there's definitely some draft regulations that we could look at to start working on those. And then just on a final note, this is a big problem. You've heard lots of solutions thrown at you. We have a lot of ideas. When U.S. Congress first passed the Trafficking Victim Protection Act back in 2000, they've reauthorized it a few times, but all on four guiding principles. And so that's how I look at how we're going to fix this. First and foremost, it's partnerships, which is why it's so great to have the coalition and have all these people at the table to work together on this. But you're partnering to address the three core P's. Prosecution. It would be amazing to have another full-time Columbus police detective on the task force. The number of cases that we're referring to them are just phenomenal. I was on the hotline myself last week on call. Yesterday we got 2 hotline calls, victims that needed help. Day before that we had 5 calls. And so we're responding to those calls and sending those referrals to police officers who are already swamped with cases. So prosecution's quite important. Prevention, which is all about public awareness. The campaign that Michelle mentioned would be an excellent idea because, like Sergeant Chrysler said, when we have uneducated juries that don't know what human trafficking is, we can't get those convictions. And then, of course, protection. So more funding for detox, AOD treatment, and shelters as well. So a little for you. But do you have any questions at all?
Well, what I'd like, if it's okay with you, Ms. Woodruff, is to connect with my staff and maybe get a email so mm-hmm. that if you have some proposed regulations and any other ideas, we certainly welcome them as we mm-hmm. tackle this issue, certainly in partnership. So thank you for your advocacy and what you do for the community.
Get my email address to them. Thank you.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Rod Borden with the Airport Authority. Now, I asked Rod to speak, Mr. Borden to speak, so thank you for sticking around to speak, because what he told me was some things that he, at the airport, he said, I'm here from the Airport Authority, and I was like, well, that's weird. Like, why are you here from the Airport Authority? But he actually mentioned some things, and I thought it would be important for you to share those, so thanks for your patience, and the floor is yours.
Well, Chairman Klein, thank you so much for inviting me to speak. I attended tonight's hearing to learn more about the efforts underway in the city of Columbus and in Central Ohio to combat human trafficking and how we at the airport might be able to contribute to those efforts. One of the things I heard numerous times tonight was the importance of awareness in combating human trafficking. And I'm very pleased to report to you that the Airport Authority has formed a partnership with the Transportation Security Administration, the TSA, to raise awareness among the entire airport community to the problem of human trafficking. I think it's safe to assume that a significant number of human trafficking victims are transported through the airport. And we got together with the TSA and determined that it would probably be a good idea to raise awareness among the airport community, and especially those employee groups that have the most frequent and closest interaction with the public, so that they might recognize the indicia of human trafficking and then be able to report that to the appropriate authorities. We assume then that that might give us opportunities to intervene and perhaps rescue some of the victims from this horrible life that they're trapped in. So that's really our objective. Our approach will be to develop a training program, and we are in the process of developing training materials and educational programs that are targeting various employee groups at the airport. We hope to begin rolling those out probably before the end of the year. So we're very enthusiastic about beginning the program, raising awareness, and getting that underway. We also look forward, though, to forging other relationships, including with many of the folks seated behind me, so that we might become a part of the larger community and the larger effort to combat human trafficking in Columbus and Central Ohio. So again, I very much appreciate your invitation to speak a little bit, and would welcome any questions and welcome other opportunities to partner with others in the room.
Well, thank you, and thanks for your patience, and thanks for sharing that and the advocacy the airport's doing and training personnel to identify human trafficking victims.
Thank you very much.
And this is the last speaker slip I have, so if anyone else wants to speak, this is your last chance to do so. And it's Veronica, and Veronica, I can't read your last name. So I, what is it?
Scherbauer.
Scherbauer. Veronica Scherbauer. Sorry, couldn't read your handwriting.
I wrote it really quickly. Thank you so much, Councilman, for having this hearing tonight. I think this is a fantastic group of people behind us who got the opportunity to speak. And really quickly, I just wanted to reiterate the point that my colleague Amy O'Grady mentioned during her time. The next annual meeting of Attorney General DeWine's Human Trafficking Commission is Monday, October 26th from 2 to 4 p.m. It's downtown at 150 East Gay Street, and we are open to the public. So if anyone is interested in attending the meeting, it's a fantastic place to meet more law enforcement, social service providers, interested members of the community, legislators, people who are interested in learning more about what's going on statewide. A lot of the coalition members also attend the commission meeting. So not only to network, but to learn about what's already being done. I encourage our friend from the Airport Authority to also attend and maybe learn about what other members of the transportation community have already done with their own trainings. Just thinking, brainstorming while he was speaking, I know the airport in Cleveland has recently done a campaign as well around human trafficking. So this is what coming to the commission meetings does. It allows people to learn about what's already going on so that we're not reinventing the wheel. You know, it helps you get a better idea of where we can move forward across the state. So I encourage everyone who's interested to please attend that meeting. If you have any questions, I have my cards and I'll be here after. I'd love to talk to you more about that meeting and encourage you to come to that. So
thank you, Ms. Scherbauer. I appreciate it. Mm-hmm. Anyone else looking to speak? Going once, twice? Okay. Well, again, thank you, everyone. I'm grateful that the experts that we have in this community were willing to sit for nearly 3 hours for this hearing. I think it exemplifies the magnitude of the problem. I'm embarrassed that people were thanking me because I haven't done anything except convene the hearing. Y'all are the folks in the field that are actually doing the work and moving the needle to raise awareness, make a difference in people's lives, and to help folks. And there's a lot to take away from this. Public awareness, the massage parlor piece. I'm just particularly drawn to the many, many hundreds, thousands of women that we're arresting and just letting back into the cycle of prostitution. And I think of Ms. Perkins, frankly, and what you shared, and to know that you were in and out of jail, and every time we let you out as a society, that you were going back in the hands of this criminal, this really bad guy that probably deserves life in jail, in my opinion. That's not what the criminal justice system's about, and we failed you, and we're failing hundreds and thousands of women, and we need to do something about it, and I don't know what that is yet, but we need to figure out that piece, because clearly we're spending the resources to throw you in jail for a couple days just to let you back out, and we need to fix that. So I look forward to working with the folks that are sitting right here to figure out whatever the heck that is, to divert those resources, to figure that out. So thank you for taking the time. I really appreciate it, and look forward to the next hearing that hopefully you all are all invited to attend, maybe about what addiction is and maybe what we're already doing in the community to address addiction. So thank you so much.